Okay, good afternoon, everybody. So today I'm the speaker. the chairperson is Galvis. Okay, so me and Milton, who is a postdoc at my lab, a NeuroMat postdoc, will be presenting this the first session of this afternoon. So that's the title, Simulations of Cortical Network Models Made of Stochastic Spiking Neurons. What I'm going to do here is kind of introduce the work of Newton, and also from my students who speak, I think, in the last session of this afternoon, and also present the overall point of view from our lab. We are interested there in Hebron-Pretto in studying dynamical phenomena in networks of spiking neurons. And this phenomena, they are due to basically two factors, which is the network topology. And by that, I mean both the structural and the functional topology, and also single unit dynamics, because the networks are made of neurons and they have their own dynamics, so the intrinsic phi and behavior. The combination of both generate emergent dynamics from the system, and if you introduce plasticity rules in those in the system as well, this will generate or provoke changes in the connectivity, both structural and functional. It can be structural because you can have homeostatic plasticity as well. And also, well, we can have rewiring or creation of new contacts and so on. And also provoke some changes in the firing behavior of the neurons. Experimental results show that neurons that behave in a certain way in vitro, when embedded in a network, in vivo, they change their behavior. So, I mean, the entire system is completely connected and circular. So everything influences itself. That's why the brain is a very interesting, complex system. We all know that. What are the dynamic phenomena that we are interested in studying? Well, basically, brain activity patterns, which could be spontaneous activity, as people call. This is the activity in the absence of external input. Evoked activity, like, for example, the one induced in the brain by the goalkeeper game or the sound, so any sequence of stimuli, or any single stimuli. That doesn't need to be any single stimulus. Okay, or task, because you can just ask the subject to perform a task, a motor task. And also, we're interested in the pathological activity, which is the activity that exists when the brain is undergoing some disorder or disease. There are several types of them. Okay. So why is it important to study? I think it's better for me to stay here. No. These activity patterns. Cortical activity is not strictly, I'll read this because I think it's important, it's not strictly determined by the sensory input, but because this is the old view, the traditional view on neuroscience is that sensory input generates our behavior. We are more or less like a stimulus response system. This is the old view, no longer the current view on neuroscience, but reflects an interaction of external stimuli with spontaneous patterns that are produced endogenously by the brain. So that's why I think the goalkeeper game is, all the protocols that we're studying, we have to consider that the brain has a state, an ongoing state when it is receiving the inputs. So the response that the brain does depends on that. But this is for discussion afterwards, no? So I give here the example, no? Of course. Yeah, of course. But the brain does that. Yeah, but you have to if you choose different protocols to study the phenomenon. We can discuss that because I mean we've been discussing this. In my point of view, there's a difference between when you do that with sound, in the way that you and Claudia and the others did, and the goalkeeper game, because in that case you have a task. But yeah, it's entirely different. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So yeah. Okay. So just to give an example, we're mostly concerned at the moment with simulating spontaneous activity, what is the spontaneous activity? So, on behalf of those who don't know, so there are different types of activities which are called spontaneous. Probably in front of you, no? So yeah, it's fine. Okay. I think that's the best spot to be. So what is, well, it could be firing of cortical neurons in the absence of external input, and this can be observed in vitro. So in that case, it's really in the absence of any external input. Could also be in vitro in growing tissue that you can grow in culture cells, and you generate circuits which are not brain, from the brain, but are brain-like. You can also create subcortical inputs to cortical layers using special tools, and then you have slabs of cortical tissue which are isolated. But also you can have, or people refer to these protocols as also spontaneous activity. So when you're sleeping, for example, a slow wave sleep, SWS, I'll be using this acronym here, or anesthesia as well. And also when you are at rest in the hotel after a long day of discussions, after some beers, you return home, you return to the hotel, and then you lay down there. You just fall on the floor, and you, as soon as you enter in a room, just do like that, no? But then you're sleeping. The idea is that it's not, you're not asleep. You're awake. You're in a state of awakeness, but without any external. So you just stay there in silence. This is what people call resting state. So the brain activity is considered to be also spontaneous in that case. Okay. Well, today, this day is mindfulness. It's very well studied. So what are the signatures of those behaviors, or the spontaneous activity, as revealed by electrophysiological studies? So for both in vitro and in vivo preparations and slow wave sleep and anesthesia, say the EEG or local field potential measurements, they reveal slow, in general of the order of 1 hertz or even less than that, and high amplitude oscillation, network oscillations, population oscillations. So the entire population, the entire network is oscillating at a very slow rate, but high amplitude. I have some pictures to show you. And so-called up and down neuronal state. So each neuron individually, the voltage membrane is either close to threshold. They are depolarized, close to threshold, but not spiking, and or hyperpolarized with a very low potential. But in the resting state, the condition that you are when you get to the hotel and lay down, the oscillations become fast and low amplitude. The ones the electrophysiologists in the room, please correct me if I'm wrong. I'm just quoting things that I've been reading in different papers. So they're fast and low amplitude network oscillations. And the neuronal firing is irregular, highly irregular. So here are some examples taken from the literature. So this is for a cortical slice in vitro. So just that first case that I've shown to you. So here you have these low oscillations and the up and down states. So here you have an up state, and from time to time you have spikes, but the voltage, the membrane voltage, is constantly at a depolarized state. And then you have a down state, in which it's very difficult for a neuron to spike. And then you have an up state, and on top of that you have spikes. This is for in vivo recordings, both in the case in the awake, a resting state, and slow wave sleep. So here you can see those slow wave sleep, you see these low waves and high amplitude oscillations, and in awake state, the high frequency and low amplitude. Here, this is the EEG, which is the field, well, it's across the scalp, but more or less is the idea of the fields, the electric fields generated by the neurons, and this is intracellular recording, and here are the raster plots. You can see here, but there should be some gray lines here, vertical lines showing the down states, which are kind of silent periods, interspersed. Sorry. Meditation could be a situation similar. Well, could be a similar situation to the awake. So you're not sleeping. You're not doing any task. Although, I mean, when you meditate, you have some your mindset, yes. You to meditate. So you're not really. Depends on. Yeah, so, that's a good question. In general, people just say awake, but I think it's when you're awake and closed eyes. You have to close your eyes. I believe if you open, then there should be some changes. But I don't know. Sergio and other electrophysiologists may know that better, much better than me.
Yeah.
Okay, but in general, this is more or less roughly, okay, yeah, yeah. So this is a generic picture, but as usual in the brain, I mean, in biology, things are different, no? When you get closer. And in physics as well. So this is a kind of cartoon from this paper here, which more or less represents the two states. So if you're awake or, I mean, just resting, you have the what people call synchronized state. So you have the oscillations, slow oscillations and high amplitude, as shown here. And you, when you are, this also happens, you don't need to be at rest, you can be active as well, no? You have so-called desynchronized state, in which, the population activity has this, more or less, desynchronized behavior. So, I mean, it would be very interesting if you can capture that on models. Especially because, in general, a model, the first step when you construct a model, a computational model, you don't submit the model to any type of stimulus. So the model would be a good candidate for a representation of a resting state of or an isolated cell culture or cell circuit, if you want. And also, I mean, if you go to neuron levels, single neuron levels, you see the neurons fire low firing rates at a sustained activity. So here you have the firing rate values, more or less. This is a distribution of firing rates from the auditory cortex of the rat. They are not non-Gaussian. This is in log normal, so they're not Gaussian. It's known that the excitatory cells have lower firing rates than the inhibitory cells. This is an important thing that all models should aim at reproducing. So in general, the inhibitory cells, they have a higher firing rate than the excitatory. Oh, by the way, there are excitatory and inhibitory cells in the brain. So this is important to keep in mind as well. They have this spontaneous behavior. And they are irregular. And a way that people used to measure the irregularity is by doing the ISI distribution. ISI is the inter-spike interval. So they counted all the inter-spike intervals between two spikes, and all consecutive spikes, and then you make a distribution of them. So, I mean, I'm quoting these guys here. So for some neurons, they fire like in a Poisson-like way, which could be random-like. But in other cases, they fire in a more regular way. So you can see here two distributions, one more Poisson-like and another one that more like a kind of normal. That they could fit by a Poisson distribution, more or less. Or the final factor, the would. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, that's the way the experimentalists refer to this. I mean, Poisson. Well, they mean a random. So usually they characterize the irregularity by what they call Fano factor or coefficient of variation. So if the coefficient of variation is close to one, the standard deviation divided by the mean, you have something that is, yeah, claimed to be Poisson-like. Yeah, but perhaps. Yeah.
Most of the time when people talk about Poisson-like discharges, they have a refractory period, and then the ISI distribution has a monoexponential decay. So when people talk about Poisson-like discharge, most of the time they have on the ISI distribution a refractory period, and then the falling phase of the ISI distribution is fitted with a monoexponential.
Yeah, in general, they fit the decaying phase by an exponential when they consider. Considering the refractory period, yeah. So that's what they mean by. So these are the kind of signatures that the modelers should try to reproduce in their models. So there are several questions that one can raise. So what would be the mechanisms responsible for existence of sustained activity in a system without external input? Because it's important, there's no, in principle, in the case of in vitro, for example, there's no external input, and the system is active during a long time. Of course, after a very long time, it decays. Do these mechanisms have some inputs, have something to do with the structure or organization of the network? So, what's the role of the topology of the network on the type of activity? what is the role of the intrinsic characteristics of the cortical neurons? So each neuron has its own dynamics. So what is the role of this? Is it as important as the topology, or is it a secondary role? What are the mechanisms that make the activity irregular in that sense, for example? I could add here lots of other things. What is the role of plasticity and so on? But this would be just enough for a start. What usually is the classical hypothesis for irregular activity? And by classical, I mean that in the sense of neuroscience, not in the sense of physics or mathematics. Neuroscience is a quite new area. Ramonica Howlett is from the end of 19th century, beginning of the 20th century. So in terms of theoretical neuroscience, in terms of using mathematics, is really much newer than that. So these guys here and some other collaborators, Van Vreeswijk and mostly Sompolinski, in the end of the 20th century, came with an Amit as well, Danny Amit and other people from that age. They came to this idea that, well, we have two populations of cells in the brain, and a population of excitatory cells and inhibitory cells, and the cortex operates in a sort of balanced state in which the average excitatory input to a given neuron is balanced by the average inhibitory input to a given neuron, so that they more or less cancel each other, and the voltage level, the main brain voltage of a given neuron is kept at a level close to threshold, more or less, just below. So, yeah, this is a hypothesis. Yeah. That would have to do with the intrinsic characteristics.
It was the opposite way. That you have the population going on.
I think, yeah.
Then you have something odd, and you act, come down.
What is known is that there are much less inhibitory cells in the brain than in the cortex than excitatory cells. There's about 80% of the cells are excitatory, 20% of them are inhibitory. So what we do to keep this balance is that the strength of the inhibitory synapses should be much higher than the strength of the excitatory synapses. So even though there are very few inhibitory cells because of the stronger synaptic input, they can sum up, add up, and balance with the excitatory input. But probably I won't be able to answer because nobody...
You were saying, you mentioned that one neuron cancels out the other. Are you referring to the mathematics?
Imagine that a single neuron is receiving 10,000 inputs from different other cells. Most of them are excitatory. A few of them are inhibitory. But the inhibitory cells have a stronger synaptic strength, if you want. So say those three people here inhibit me and the rest excite me. I'm exaggerating. So those guys here, they inhibit me. And then, I mean, how can I be in a closed, silent phase?
Okay, but
if
then
the strength of their connections to me is high, is stronger than the strength of yours. So when you sum x from them, x1, x2, x3, and so on, minus y1, y2, and so on. All when right. You sum both, I mean, my activity, my level, if you want, is close to zero. So what would promote me to fire would be just a fluctuation on this.
Okay,
so that's why my fire would be irregular.
In this sense, you're only considering the electrical activity behind it. Is that it? Or am I not understanding it?
I'm considering, well, the brain activity, firing rate, the fire. Neurons communicate via connection, via the firings, which is electrical. Of course, they have the chemical synapses, but the strength of the chemical synapses is stronger for the, is higher for the inhibitor. But yeah, I'm considering the... I could go back to the very slides to the beginning and say, well, there's a dogma in neuroscience today which hasn't yet been challenged, which is the so-called neuron doctrine. So neurons are the important cells and they communicate via spikes. Even this has been challenged. So, I mean, everything is, yeah. But, yeah. Yeah, EPSPs, yeah, of course, yeah. Arvan Itaki, yeah, no, I'm very much interested in EPSPs interactions, but I mean, this is another story, another talk, and also there's glia as well. So, I mean, in 200 times, people would be laughing at us. Oh, those people in the early 21st century, they believed that neurons and spikes were the most important things, as much as we do today. Yeah, this guy, yeah, this. Okay, but I'm losing my time, so I'm sorry. Anyway, so, I mean, this is the so-called classical hypothesis, and it has been pursued by many, many researchers. So what is the classical implementation of this hypothesis to test it? So I call this the classical model. So it's a network which uses which is basically a Erdős-Reni graph, with 80% of the cells being excitatory, 20% of them being inhibitory, sparse connections. So the number of connections is much smaller than the number of neurons. The neurons are modeled by the integrating fire, the most popular candidate for simple neuron to be used in large networks of this kind. And also the conditions for the self-sustained activity would be that the inhibitory synapses are stronger than the excitatory synapses, as we have been discussing. And in most cases, they apply an external stimulus, a kind of background stimulus to the network to keep it going on. If you stop that, the network dies out. So this is the classical model. And the classical model per se is the Brunel model, Nicolas Brunel, who now is in the States, in Chicago, but he was in France at that time. So by studying both via computational models and also analytically, it's a very interesting paper. I think Rodrigo Pena can talk about it. He had a course on that in Germany, no? But anyway, so I mean, he was able to study the model. He had two parameters: the ratio between the strength of the inhibitory synapse to the strength of the excitatory synapse in the model. So people usually call this G. And also here is the strength, the normalized strength of this external, the background input. So by varying the two parameters, he was able to show that the network, the Erdős-Reni network, has four regimes, or well, five if you want. There's a silent, of course, but there's a regime which he called synchronous regular. So the first he would refer to the population. The population has a synchronous or asynchronous firing. And the second one would refer to the neurons, so the individual cells, which would be firing either regularly or irregularly. So this is the synchronous regular behavior, which is epileptic-like, so kind of very. So the population is firing synchronously, and the neurons, each neuron is also firing. This is a threshold value for the excitatory input. This would be the rate of the Poisson input that they use as background. So this is to be the synchronous regular. There will be a region here in this diagram in which they would have a synchronous behavior. So this is the population here. Yeah, G equal 4 is the magic number for the balance. So the balance, yeah. The balance, yeah, is this magic number 4. So the ratio between the inhibitory and the excitatory strengths would be close to 4. So the people are using this value for in different other models, even with different topologies. More or less, yeah, more or less like that. So, I mean, I don't have time. But of course, we can carry on discussing. But yeah, I'm just presenting to you what people, if you go through most of the models that are there in the market. Please correct me if I'm wrong, but most of them are considering this kind of model. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
And if you increase the rate, you have a very fast gamma.
You be going this, yeah, you go, yeah.
Exactly what we see in the retina during the anesthesia. Because when you give haloperidol,
yeah, the inhibition, and also you make it more susceptible to noise. Yeah, of the external.
Of the neuron.
No, but this is not the rate of the neurons. This is the rate of the background input. So this would be similar to exposing the retina to more, say, noise. This is a kind of measure of the background noise, and this is a measure of the ratio between inhibition and excitation. It's a very simple, it's very easy to simulate. You can download it and simulate. Very difficult to be analyzed because the integrating fire model, although very simple, very popular, it's a discontinuous model, so it's not easy to be studied. That's why the GL model may be, although it does also integrate in fiber, but it has some nice features to it. But anyway, so this is the point here is not is that since the publication of this work, which was at the beginning of the century, most people in the community more or less believe in that. So they keep using the terms, and the holy grail of this is to get this AI state, which is the self-sustained asynchronous and irregular. So it's a desynchronized state, similar to the desynchronized state which is observed in awakened subjects. So people try to tune the model to be in that region. And most of the researchers who are doing modeling in computational neuroscience try to tune their models to be in that region, because that would be the default model for them. And people use AI, and AI is like, yeah, sorry. So this is the state here. So you have a kind of asynchronous population, although you still have some oscillations, it's not like that. And the activity of single neurons is irregular. So just to give you another example, this is a semi-classical model because it's not as classical as the Brunel, but the Vogels and Abbott model also is a popular one. It's the same model, more or less at the same time. And then you can have here the classifications of all this, the four states that I mentioned to you and so on. I'm not going through. So the proposal that we want to pursue in my lab is to go beyond this classical model. We don't want to keep reproducing the same type of model. So we want to study networks with different or more realistic architectures, and we want to study network neuromodels, and also networks of neurons that have higher diversity of firing behaviors. So, diversity of cells, yeah. Cells with different firing patterns. So the idea is to use the GL model, the Galvez-Loscherbach model, to simulate neurons with different firing behaviors. As Osami mentioned, I'll go back to this in a few slides, but we'll try to use the stochastic model of Galvez and Loscherbach to fit the firing behavior of different types of neurons, and then put them into the model and see how the... Of course, this is something that is important for simulations. For mathematicians, may be difficult to use as... Yeah. So you can use it. Yeah. So that's the idea. We're kind of defending that this model can be used to simulate. It can allow different tools than the ones that are used by people who work on the integrated and fire model. So we are doing this. We are studying large scale models, and by large scale I mean. You can define what is a large scale based on very simple back of the envelope calculations from anatomical data. So the probability of synaptic contacts between any two cortical neurons chosen at random is close to 0.1. You can ask that to the people who were here last year discussing the random graphs in the brain. And the mean number of synapses per cortical neuron is of the order of 10,000. So the average number is that. So the minimum number of cells that you need to have in your model for that to be considered a large scale model is of the order of 10 to the fifth, which implies a number of synapses of the order of 10 to the ninth, because you have 10 to the fourth. So that's it. So this is the minimum size of a large scale network, which would be a local cortical network, just a cortical column. And then to go to a large scale model, one would have to add those local cortical models to create area models, so models of area V1, V2, A1, M1, and so on, and then add them into a full model of the cortex, and then you'd have a macroscopic network model, brain size. And for that, we'd probably use data from fMRI or imaging studies to know the topology of how the areas are connected to each other. So that's the overall goal. So at the moment, we are working at the local cortical model, and we are using this also on the way of becoming a classical model, which is the model by Portians and Diesmann, published in 2014. He was announced much earlier than that. So it's a model that takes into account layer and neuron type specific connectivity about how neurons are connected. It kind of condensates lots of experimental data from many, more than 50 papers, works by Thompson's lab, Binziger's, and people in Germany in different laboratories. I don't have time to describe the model here, but they give a recipe of how to construct such a network. They give the probabilities of connection. Well, basically, the model has four layers. You know that the cortex is organized into layers, usually six layers. But in the model, they lump the second and the third layer into a single one. They don't consider the first layer. And they have a layer 4, layer 5, and layer 6. So we have four layers and two cell populations. So there's actually eight populations in this model. Excitatory cells from the layer 2, 3, excitatory cells from layer 4, layer 5, and 6, and inhibitory cells from all of them. And there are probability of connections between any pair of cells from these eight populations. And they give estimates for those probabilities based on experimental data. So you can construct your realization of this model, and you can construct several realizations of this model to simulate if you want. And then you also have a thalamic input, which would be the external input applied, which go to layer 4 and layer 6. And also you can have background input if you want. In their model, they consider, again, the integrate and fire, the leaky integrate and fire cell. They use the same leaky integrate and fire model for both excitatory and inhibitory cells, so they don't, although they have the two as different anatomically, dynamically they are the same because they are modeled by the same neuron. So I don't believe in that. I think nobody, because the cells have different behaviors. But anyway, they use the same model. And they were able to reproduce by also going to that magic number 4, so the ratio between the inhibitory strength to the excitatory strength is close to 4. Actually, it's 4. No, it's actually exactly 4. And by tuning it to be 4, they have an asynchronous irregular activity, which is shown here, and also higher fine rate of inhibitory neurons. So here you have the inhibitory cells from each layer always have higher fine rates than the excitatory cells. But they were also able to reproduce more or less the similar ratios of excitatory rates to inhibitory rates in each layer, according to measurements. One thing that's important to mention, I think Newton, we're going to talk about this, and also Rodrigo, is that in their published paper, Cerebral Cortex, they show this raster plot here. This raster plot shows only 2.5% of the cells in the model. Usually people do that. When they show the raster plot, they don't plot the 100% of the cells. So here you can see that a nice asynchronous and irregular behavior. But the model is public. It's available here. We downloaded the model, and Newton ran it. He'll show the plots to you. If you have a raster plot with 100% of the cells, you see oscillations. You don't see an asynchronous irregular behavior. No, you don't see. I mean, you just run their model, their parameters, everything, and then the raster plot is not like that. Yeah. And one thing that they say is that the model misses about 50% of the synapses, which. Yeah, Newton was going to show it for. So, I mean, this shows that the model is really not enough to be considered as a good, say, cortical model. It's just a cortical column. About half of the synapses that cells in that little cortical column receive come from other areas. So you really need to have a larger scale model, which is something that people that are Jülich, because this is the model from Jülich, are doing. No, they are now considering. So this is the paper they published this year in 2016. They are using that cortical model, cortical column model, to construct a large scale model of 32 areas involved in visual processing in the macaque cortex. They're using the COCOMAC database, publicly available database of connectivity from the macaque, which was done, by the Allen Institute in the US, and then they inherited this database. Well, it's public, you can use it. So here's the model as a topology. So they have V1, V2, V4. Probably you cannot see here, but somewhere in V4, and they are doing say, producing raster plots for each column and so on. They have population rasters, and also they are calculated correlations and many other measures which are important. So we also want to get to that point, but first we are trying to work on the single column model. I'm showing this just to show you, I mean, where we are aiming at. So going now to the neural models, the single neural models, how to model a single neuron? Well, the different candidates, the most popular one is the integrate and fire here, integrate and fire, but then we have lots of other ones. Of course, this was done by Izikevich, so Izikevich is the best model, according to him, is the most efficient and the most biologically plausible. Perhaps you can put the GL, I have to run up because I'm in the middle of my talk. Five more, but okay, yeah. But I'll have to. So, I mean, just, I mean, that, yeah, there are lots of simple spiking neural models there in the market that you can use. When I talk about dimensionality for the non-mathematicians in the room, is the number of variables that you use to represent the model. So the lower, the better in terms of understanding. So one-dimensional, two-dimensional are the better one. The Hodgkin-Huxley model would be too complicated because at least they are four-dimensional. But those models, to be low-dimensional, they are not explicit. So they don't have ionic channels, they don't have conductances, but I mean, they are okay for simulating large-scale networks. The emphasis on the neuron response. So you have here lots of them. This Ceballos model, the adaptive exponential integrating fire, which is a model that we are also using. I don't have the time to go into that. And the idea of using those different models is to reproduce the different personalities that cortical neurons have. Because cortical neurons, they don't behave in the same way. So if you do a very simple experiment in vitro, you inject current and keep the current constant for a long time, and then you measure the rate of spikes, the firing rate of the cell, and then you do that for different current values, and then you do a plot. I'll define this later as the FI plot. You see that the firing behavior depends on the type of cell you are considering. They don't behave in the same way. So you have so-called regular spiking cells, which are adaptive cells, so they start with a higher rate, and then they adapt to a regular rate, and they keep firing in a regular way. They are usually glutamatergic, which means excitatory cells. They are the most important excitatory cells in the brain. You have fast repetitive bursting or just intrinsically bursting cells, which are bursting. Well, I don't have time to describe all of them, but the most important would be the regular cells and the fast spiking cells for this talk. The fast ones are non-adaptive cells, so they don't adapt. They fire at a very high rate, and they are inhibitory cells. They are GABAergic cells. That's why the inhibitory cells fire at a higher rate. So this is more or less the canon, but some people have observed that experimentally, neurons that behave in a certain way in vitro, when studied in vivo, i.e. embedded in the network, they can change their firing behavior. So bursting cells can become like regular spiking cells because of the network effect. Not all of them, but some of them change their firing pattern. So this is a network effect. And also neurons display stochastic behavior. No, we can see that by studying both in vitro and in vivo. So for example, there's trial-to-trial variability in vitro, so you do several repetitions of an experiment and you see that the firing behavior is not always the same when you superpose them. Also in vivo, you repeat, say, the presentation of same random dot stimuli to the network, and then you do several trials and you see that there's some dispersion here. So there's some stochasticity in the behavior. Where does this stochasticity come from? They come from different sources, so this is from Linda. There could be intrinsic channel noise, so the ionic channels, they have this random behavior, so they can trigger firing of the cells. Also, the synapses are unreliable, they're stochastic. Also, the vesicles released, the vesicles that fuse with the membrane and the neurotransmitters that are released, they vary. And this also is a source of a very important source of stochasticity. And also, some people say that if you had a totally deterministic network with deterministic neurons, you wouldn't have random noise because everything would be deterministic. But since cells are intrinsically stochastic, this would create a random network noise, because there are 10,000 cells making synapses to each single cell, and the bombardment that they receive would, say, generate this random behavior. This is the network noise. Now I have to run, because Marcondes is here. So, so how to model that? There are two ways. You can either directly model it as a stochastic process, as the Galvez-Lochebar, or you can add the noise to the model. You can use your favorite deterministic model, and then you add noise to it. So this would be just for the students, but what is an FI curve? I probably won't go into that. You just have the frequency against the current. I already have defined, so you can characterize different behaviors. Yeah. Okay. So you can characterize different ways, different firing behaviors using by determining experimentally the FI curve for each cell type. So you have your regular spiking cell, you just do as I said before, you apply currents with different voltage levels, and then you calculate the frequency during this time window, and then you have a point here, and then you increase the current, and you keep doing that, and you have a curve, which is so-called FI curve. It's a kind of signature for a neuron. Kind of myopic one, but it's a signature for the neuron. So, and then you have here for different types of neurons, fast spiking, chattering, which are like a like chattering neurons, so they have short duration bursts. You have the intrinsically bursting, which have an initial burst, and then they turn into a kind of regular firing. And you also can do the distribution of the firing of the interspike interval, to see if they behave in a Poisson-like or not. So you can characterize neurons. So if you want to use, say, GL model or any other model to fit to reproduce a neuron, you should be able to reproduce the general behavior that, because the other models do that. So the ones who work on leak integrating fire or ADEX or Isikevich, they do that. So here is the interesting paper Foucault Tokme. They studied Wang Buzaki exponential integrating fire, quadratic integrating fire, and the leak integrating fire. So the difference is that leak integrating fire is a linear model. I had a slide with the equations, but I took it. So this is just a linear. The quadratic is a quadratic relation between dvdt and the function of v that characterizes the behavior. Exponential is just an exponential. Wang-Buzak is a more biophysical model. So you do that. You take the models and submit them to each model to currents, so different intensities, and then you construct the firing FI curve for the model. And you also can do that submitting the model to stochastic or Poisson-like inputs, or constant current with some fluctuation. And then you have the FI curve. So here you see that there are differences, and then you can see how the model fit the actual, say, behavior of a spiking of a cell. Okay. Of course, the leak integrating fire, you have just a discontinuity there, so you have that discontinuous behavior, but well, anyway. So now going to our world famous Galvez-Lochebar model, GL model, in the Brocchini et al. Version, the version that was just published, the model that we have been discussing here, Osami and so on. So this is the way I took this from the paper. This is the representation, the mathematical representation of the model. You all know about this by now. We are considering this firing function, the probability of the neuron firing for a given value of v. So this it's gamma times v minus vt to the r. And so it's this function for different values of the exponent r. If r is less than 1, you have this type of behavior. If r is larger than, you have a concave and so on and so forth, or you have a linear one. Okay. So if you want to use the model to construct a large-scale network model, the first question that comes is, which is a question that mathematicians probably don't need to ask, but we who do model, do we need to? Yeah. We need to. No. So we have to choose a criterion to determine the exact value of v at which a spike occurs. So when does a spike occur? And then one has to estimate the phi of v, the probability of neuron firing for that value. So I think this will become more obvious for you now. So what is the V of a spike? At which value the neuron has a spike? If you consider just a set of ones and zeros, that's easy. But in the real life, how, or in the model? So how to determine that? In vitro, when you do an experiment in vivo, it's relatively easy. You just do that kind of experiment. So you submit the cell to different step values of the current, from very low to increasingly high currents. And then you determine the minimum value of the current at which the neuron emits a spike. And then you get the associated value of the voltage for that value. So this would be the threshold voltage, the voltage at the neuron really spikes. You can do that as well, submitting the network to input currents. But in vivo, how do you determine that in vivo? In vivo, you don't have this control. You cannot submit the cell in vivo to different input currents. So usually what people do is to determine the onset voltage. So you need to find to define a criterion, usually based on the first derivative or the second derivative of the voltage in a diagram like that. And then if the first derivative crosses a certain threshold, you say, well, that's the onset. That's the point at which the spike occurs. Before that, it doesn't occur. So by doing that, you can determine the points at which, if the voltage is above that point, you have a spike. But this, of course, depends on time. As we know, the spiking depends on the past. So the voltage threshold varies from time to time. This can be done. This is just to show you that there's that different methodologies based on the second derivative. For that, you probably cannot see here, but there's a circle here indicating that is at that point that the voltage, that the first derivative of this function here that they find in terms of the first derivative, it starts to increase. That's the point, the onset point. And based on that, you can determine the onset point for different spikes. You probably, I hope you can see here, different black dots that fluctuate. They are not at the same level. So the starting, the onset of each spike varies with time. This is for real cells, two different cells, A and B. So this is the first problem, how to define the onset voltage. So this is a methodology that can be done from experimental data. So you can determine when a spike occurs. And then how to determine the probability, the phi of V. Based on that, you can do the following. You submit you take this time series, the voltage, for different experiments. And then you do you bin that, as has been discussed yesterday. And then you construct two distributions, a distribution of the voltage values when the neuron doesn't spike, and then the distribution of the voltage values at which the neuron spikes. This would be the threshold V here in black. And then you superpose the two in a histogram like that. This would be for neuron A, this would be for neuron B. And then how you estimate your probability of firing, just by counting for each bin how many times it has fired and how many times it has fired and not fired. And then you divide one by one, the usual way. So this is the empirical way of determining phi of V. This can be done from an experimental. Yeah. Yeah. So this is very good because we need that. We need to have probably better ways of defining this. We are doing this, no? So this is very, very preliminary data because we don't have access. Perhaps Sergio can help us and other experimentalists. But Cesar, who is here, he's at my lab, but he's also doing experiments at the physiology, one of the physiology labs at Ribeirão Preto, at the medical school, with Professor Ricardo Leão. He's working with a pyramidal cell from CA1 region from the hippocampus, and he gave us some data. And based on that, we had the two distributions, the two histograms, the voltage values for non-firing, the voltage at which the cell didn't fire, and here are the voltage values at which the cell fired, using that criterion of the second derivative. So we calculated the onset V value for that. The problem is that, as you can see here, by the orders of magnitude, we had very few spikes for the time series that you have. So we are not able to determine a very good probability function because the counting here is much smaller than the counting there. And also you see there are some high voltage values for which the neuron doesn't spike. So the data is not as nice as this one here, in which they kind of end at the same point. We have the light gray curve going to higher values. But probably this is we have to improve the statistics. Perhaps if we have more data from cortical cells, we could be able to have a better estimate. Anyway, we're trying to do this. But since we also want to construct our large-scale models, we have to find other ways to determine the phi of V function. So what would be an alternative one? So use the FI curve. That's why I insisted on the FI in defining what is an FI curve to you. I'm getting close to the end. So we know the FI curves for experimental cells. And better than that, we know the FI curves of the models that I used to fit the behavior of the experimental cells. So since we don't have access to many experimental data, but we have the models, and according to their creators, like Zikevich, the models are quite good in reproducing the firing behavior of the cells, we can fit the average behavior of the GL model, which is stochastic, to the FI curve of any model that you want. So this is only for Zikevich, but we have done that for the ADEX as well, the adaptive exponential model. So we take here in red the FI curve for the regular spiking neuron and the fast spiking cell, the two types, the two most important cells in the cortex, one excitatory, one inhibitory. And then by adjusting the parameters, so I just mixed the two slides. So we took the equation phi of V for the GL model. We had to add this delta here because the fast spiking cells are what people call type 2 cells. They start firing at a non-zero frequency. So we added a delta here. Since the cells are isolated, we had to change slightly the model. So we had to add to multiply the current by the resistance of the cell, as people do in the leaf as well, to have a consistent equation there. And then we fixed some parameters and changed the other ones and use some minimization method to find the better values. And we got to those parameter values here anyway. So this we can improve that anyway. But the idea is that we did some fitting and we got, sorry, let's go back to, yeah. So we got here the stochastic Galvez-Loschebaugh versions of regular spiking and fast spiking cells. So you see they are stochastic, they are error bars here. And you can here see the behavior. So this is the deterministic ones, the deterministic versions, and these are the stochastic versions. And they behave like, if you do a real experiment, you more or less would get things similar to this, not to this, because in real life, the cells are stochastic. So they are spiking in a stochastic way. So now we have at least reasonably good candidates to use in our large-scale models. But this is a talk for Newton and the other guys. I'm just prepared. I just show to you all the steps that we have to fulfill in order to be able to simulate a large scale model. So there are lots of work in progress, and that's it. Okay? Please visit us at Ribeirão Preto. That's where we are, about 300 kilometers from São Paulo. We have a nice opera house, a nice campus there, a beautiful lake. It's a big city, lots of bars and bookstores and places things to do. No? We're all welcome to go there. Okay? I think Newton needs to talk before we finish the session. Because Newton had the... No, yeah, we haven't yet finished.
I won't take long.
Yeah, because now I have to talk about most of the things.
Eu mudo aqui mesmo. Okay, so just continue. Well, I don't think I need introduction. So just continue. So, well, Professor Roque already mentioned about the structure of the cortical microcircuit, that it's layered. So just so you guys have an image of what how the layers are. And you can see here that the neurons, as was just mentioned, they have different classes, different types of neurons at different layers. And in some species, for example, in we humans, the cells with similar receptive field properties and functions, for example, in the visual cortex, we have cells that respond to a certain orientation, and they're grouped all together. And different orientation selective groups of cortical columns, it's what they're called, they are arranged in the cortex. So, and that's what we call the cortical columns. It's a group of neurons that has the same properties and functions. And this is just an example of different properties, response properties of cortical neurons, and well, which was already mentioned just in the previous talk. So, and what I'm working on is the Poisson-Dismal model, which is about 80,000 neurons, and it would be something similar to my cortical column. And well, for layers, excitatory inhibitory neurons, but this model was only modeled with a single type of leaky integrating fire neuron model. And here, what I'm trying to do is to use, for example, the Zikevich model or the ADEX model for, and they have the regular spiking for excitatory, or the fast spike or non-adaptive neurons for inhibitory neurons. So that is different classes of neurons for the excitatory and inhibitory. And of course, as was just introduced, we can obtain the GL version of those two types of neurons. So I'm also planning to work with those stochastic neural models. And they claimed, yes, the original model. This is the original model that I installed their simulator and everything, they code. It's everything original. And they claimed it's asynchronous, but as you can see here, there are a lot of regularity here. But, well, we'll take this as our starting point. Although they have recently just published a paper, it was this year, where they are analyzing this synchrony. So they already know that they are synchrony on their model. And just actually, I did try to do with the deterministic Zikevich and ADEX RS and FS neurons, but the results were not, I think the orders are not correct. This is the correct order.
Yes.
Interestingly, you see that the supergranular layers, they show a very strong, I wouldn't say they would, but a kind of a spontaneous gamma oscillation. And in the experimental data, this is exactly the case. And I tell you, I never believed this, but my whole experimental data, I realized that this may be really true in the primary visual cortex of the monkey, because it's like that you have layers of oscillatory, very strong oscillatory components, and it's not uniform across the layers. So this is interesting.
Thank you. Yeah.
A question. Yes. I will try to speak louder. What's the solver that you use?
Sorry?
What is the solver that you use?
The solver.
The solver for the differential equation.
Sorry, I didn't check out the code. It was simulated using Nest, and the model is already there. So you
didn't try any other solver.
I didn't try any other solver. Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, we just try to reproduce the model as it is packaged as it comes from Euclid.
And when I tried to implement it with using different classes of neural models. There are the Ezekiewicz regular spiking and Ezekiewicz fast spiking. I couldn't obtain the desired results. At least the Poisson-Dismal model, they have the layer, the firing rate of the layers, they are physiologically plausible. If we use two types of different classes of neurons, you put it, and I try to change all the parameters, the weights, and everything to get closer to their, to at least for the firing rate, it was impossible. I couldn't obtain a good result for the firing rate, and for the raster plot, it became much more. Synchronous.
So this contradicts Dismal.
This contradicts, yeah.
Our friend Mark.
No, yeah. We are using their model, and this shows very. The first thing is that you have the same topology, the same graph. You just changed it. You just added for the excitatory and inhibitory cells two different dynamical models. So you just changed the unit dynamic unit. No. But I mean, I hope he is a scientist. Yes, Sonia Green, I think she should be very interesting to be here as well. We can invite
more the whole experimental data.
No, I don't know.
We have Magnet organize a workshop with Marcus Diesel and
you can discuss
this.
But in this mode, actually, it's still a simplified version in the sense that the excitatory connections from one layer to the other, they are all considered. With the same, not exactly the same, they have some distribution, but about the same magnitude, as well as from the inhibitor to the excitatory, and so forth. So what I'm trying to do here right now is to search for a set of wave, layer-dependent wave.
Yeah, so now we're going towards not a single G value, which is the ratio between the strength of the inhibitory to the excitatory for the entire network. So there should be, as seems natural, to have balanced states, if you want, for each layer, so of each type of connection. So excitatory to excitatory, excitatory to inhibitory, inhibitory to excitatory, inhibitory. Yeah, so four. It would be more parameters, be more complicated, more closer to reality. No?
Yes. And, but interestingly, this was only when we used the Galvez-Loscherba model fitted to the Ezekiewicz RS neuron. Here I only used one type of neuron. If you put again here RS and FS, it messes up.
That's the stochastic version of the Ezekiewicz model. So the previous one was just the deterministic. That's with your model. The GL, we're just using GL RS. We're using the Ezekiewicz version of the RS because you have the real neurons. Regular spiking, fast spiking. You can implement them using Ezekiewicz or ADEX, or mostly Ezekiewicz and ADEX, quadratic or exponential, the deterministic versions. And then you have the stochastic versions, which we call GL, EASY, RS, because that's the stochastic version of the, in that way that I shown to you, that we fitted the FI curve of the Ezekiewicz version of the RS. So this is the GL, EASY, RS. We have also the GL, AD, or ADEX of the RS. And we have the GL easy for the FS, the fast spiking, and the GL ADEX FS as well. So what he's showing here is that if we replace the original leaf models of the Poisson-Dismal which is the same for both excitatory and inhibitory neurons, by a single stochastic model, which was the fitted model for the regular spiking. So we're using the regular spiking to model both excitatory and inhibitory cells. We reobtain more or less the same type of behavior that the Porchens Disman used. So this may reveal that the Zikevich and Nadex, which are two-dimensional integrate and fire models, they may have some sort of, they add some, artifact. There's some artifact related to the structure of the model, which is not present in the leaf model, which also is not present in the GL, in your model, in Galvez-Lochebar model, because structurally you are like a leak integrate and fire model. And you're different from the, and Rodrigo is also going to discuss that in his talk, his 10-minute talk, because the Zikevich and Dadex are two-dimensional models. So they have the way in which...
The difference, you want to know the difference between this one and the original Porchens Disman model or the... Oh, then I didn't put any equation here at this time because...
Yeah,
Zikevich, sorry, you cannot model using a leaf, because leaf is always the same behavior. So you can model using Zikevich, which is a quadratic integrate and fire, or you can model it via ADEX, which by the way is Gerstner-Brette model, but they don't like to put their names in the model. So this is a exponential.
It's not my fault.
Yeah, no, no, we are insisting on that. But at least you are different from Zikevich. Well, Zikevich himself, he didn't put his name. No, he started to call his, but before that he didn't call. Anyway, you can model this via these two. And the thing is, since we don't, if we had access to the experimental data from those cells, we could do a pure GL version, as I mentioned to you before. So we can't have data series, time series of those cells, experimental cells, and then we can do some statistical measurements and determine the phi of V for those cells, and then we can construct purely GL versions of them. Since we don't have access to that, we are using the FI curves from these two models, so given FI curves, and then we are using the GL model, let's put it here, to create versions of the Zikevich implementation of the regular spiking that represented in a stochastic way. Do you understand? Did you get that? And we are calling this GL easy RS. That's the stochastic, the Galvez-Lochebar version of the regular spiking based on the FI curve simulated. Now you got it, no? And you have the same thing, the GL ADEX for the RS, and here the same thing. No, we have a model, so we have a GL version based on the easy model, Zikevich of the fast spiking. Sorry, and also have a GL version of the ADEX for the fast spiking. So they are kind of second-hand models because that's the best thing we could do at the moment, since we are not experimentalists. We don't have access to the real data, at least in sufficient numbers that allow us to fit. To construct a pure GL version. That would be the easiest. So in that case, we could disregard the Zikevich and ADEX implementations. We could just fit or adjust the firing function of V based on measurements. And the best thing would be to have versions from in vivo situations. That would be the ideal case. So did you get it now?
No. I mean, that part I got. Yeah. I just wanted to understand one remark you made. Maybe I misunderstood. Yeah. I'm interested in knowing if you saw any difference in the regularities that you that the both increase in regularity and synchronicity yeah. that you observe with the Ezekavich model. If it's that somehow diminishes, or how does it make a difference when you implement the GL, EZ, RS, LF? FS.
We don't have all the answers to that because we're struggling so much to get an asynchronous irregular. Perhaps this has demanded too much from us, and we are going to take it the wrong way because we are doing what most other people are doing. They are trying to obtain an asynchronous and irregular without paying attention to what the model is showing to us. So now we have to stop trying to get to an asynchronous irregular, just run the model as it is, and then do all those measurements, synchronicity, synchrony index, and all the autocorrelations, cross-correlations, all kinds of measurements that people are doing. You may have some data to show, no? No, not for here, but we are planning to do that, yeah. But yeah,
you mentioned the possibility of artifacts. In fact, the reason of my first question about the solver is that, if I remember correctly, there's a paper by David Ancel, Herman Matteau, and Claude Meunier about the effect of discretization on the LIF model. And if you're not careful, you can get spurious synchronization because you force neurons to spike at a given time. So you have to compute the true time of crossing and then
Yes, we discussed this at the beginning. And also Rodrigo can talk. We discussed that. Yeah, this is a common error. So since it's a discrete time, and before the threshold you don't fire, after threshold you fire. When you cross the threshold during time delta t, you can you collapse all the points above threshold into a single point in your representation, single voltage point. Yeah, we are aware of that. So we are trying. We are correcting this in our simulations. We are doing this correction. I think Rodrigo can.
Sorry, I just want to add, because we also made an investigation about different types of solvers, and at some point we tried Kunji-Kutta for a forwarder with 0.01 step size, which is rather low, and the whole oscillation thing did not disappear. So I think this problem of oscillation, it's not due to the time step or the solver. So I mean, it doesn't change the picture.
And also, Rodrigo is going to present some.
I think I should play my role of
chairman. Yeah.
So I think I ask Newton to make a final.
To wrap up, yeah. And then we can discuss this. Yeah.
Very short.
No, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Very short. And then you continue and use the
actually thank you very much.
Bom, boa tarde, obrigado pelo convite. Good morning. Sir? Yes, I'm sitting here. good afternoon. Thank you very much for this invitation and for the possibility to talk about FAPESP. So my name is Roberto Cesar. I'm a professor at the computer science department across the street, you all know. But also I'm an advisor to Professor Brito Cruz, who is the scientific director of FAPESP, and then I'm representing him today. I'm going to talk, since we have people from here, from São Paulo, that knows well FAPESP, but also people from outside, I'm going to talk a little bit in general about FAPESP and the research environment that we have in the state of São Paulo. And then I'm going to talk a little bit more focused on the CEPIDs, so it may be something that you're interested in. As Antonio mentioned, please feel free to raise your hands and ask any time, any questions, or make comments. If we can interact, I suppose it would be better. Okay. Actually, the talk has three parts. I'm going to talk first about the research system that we have in the state of São Paulo. Then I'm going to talk a bit about FAPESP, which plays a key role in this research system. And then I'm going to talk about the CEPIDs. So these are the three parts that I'm going to address. So for those of you that outside from São Paulo or outside from Brazil, here's Brazil, here's São Paulo. We are here located in São Paulo. São Paulo, as I mentioned, has an important, significant research system in the in the context of Brazil. I'm not going to jump into the details, into the data, but I'm going to talk about two main numbers that helps to understand the importance of the state of São Paulo regarding science and technology in the country. If you take the whole Latin America, so from Mexico, you can imagine that, from Mexico to Chile, for every four papers published in the whole Latin America, two are published in Brazil, and one is published in São Paulo. So São Paulo is responsible for 1/4, 25% of the science, taking any number you want, PhD theses or published papers or citations or books, take any number you want. São Paulo is responsible for half of that. So 25% of the whole production of the whole Latin America is produced here in the state of São Paulo. This explains the importance of the infrastructure that we have in terms of scientific production. And then we have a number of who are doing that. A number of universities, public universities, private universities, state universities, federal universities, isolated institutions. There's a number of institutions that are doing this issue. Another number that helps to understand the infrastructure in the state of São Paulo is the number of companies that are doing research in some sense. So São Paulo has nearly 15,000 companies doing some kind of research. And this is important to understand because this is something that in general we used to say here in Brazil. Companies are not interested in doing research in the country, we do not can convince them to hire our PhD students and so on and so forth. 15,000 companies doing some kind of research in the state of São Paulo is something quite relevant in many terms. This system, if you want to understand the size of the system that is doing this, FAPESP receives each year nearly 25,000 new proposals. And there are 20,000 different scientists applying for FAPESP. So this is the size of the system. 20,000 scientists and students and so forth, and submitting 25 new proposals each year. This system is funded by federal sources, state-level sources, private sources, public sources. There is a number of different issues, which is, makes the state of São Paulo comparable to other, for instance, other countries. If you take the percentage of the GDP or something like this, it, São Paulo is comparable to, say, the Europe or Spain or something like this. So this is the system that is running and it's helping to make us here now meeting and discussing science and discussing firing neurons and so on and so forth. This is the system that is has been running. This is a map that shows a number of cities. Each small ball here is proportional to the number of scholarships being funded by FAPESP in some city, which means that which shows that São Paulo is more or less well covered in terms of different institutions doing research in different places. Here you can see São Paulo, Campinas, Araraquara, Ribeirão Preto, and so forth. I'm going to skip this. The size, as I mentioned, these numbers that I mentioned, the scientific production, if you count regarding, for instance, number of published papers, so São Paulo is responsible for half of the scientific production in Brazil. Here you see the evolution of Brazil. Here you see the evolution of São Paulo. And as you can see, São Paulo is more or less responsible for half of that. The second number that explains an additional key issue regarding this is that it's not just a matter of size, for instance, the population of São Paulo. Because one way of doing the analysis, it would be to say, well, but there are more people in São Paulo, so it's normal that there are more science being produced in São Paulo. Or there is more money in São Paulo, because economically is the more, most powerful state, so there is more science in São Paulo. This is not like this, actually. São Paulo has 20% of the Brazilian population, 35% of the GDP, and 50% of the science. So it's not only concentrated in terms of the number, but it's also there's more efforts going on in São Paulo that explains this, this situation. So this is the first step, the first part that I mentioned that I would like to show to discuss the research infrastructure that we have in the state. Then one of the key actors in this system is FAPESP, as you know. FAPESP has been funded in 1962, so 54 years ago. FAPESP, for those that are not from Brazil, it's important to mention. FAPESP funds research in all domains of knowledge. So it's not an agency focused on some system like NIH, for instance, in the US, or NSF, or so on and so forth. So FAPESP funds research in all domains of knowledge. Its budget is nearly half a billion US dollars per year. And its budget comes from taxes paid by taxpayers in the state of São Paulo, which explains why FAPESP can only fund research associated to some institution in the state of São Paulo. There's a number of different opportunities that FAPESP funds. So FAPESP can fund scholarships, as you know. FAPESP can fund grants. FAPESP can fund companies. And FAPESP can fund research together with companies. So these are the different ways that FAPESP funds research, basically the overall big picture regarding the funding mechanisms that, that FAPESP has. So FAPESP has, in terms of grants, three types of grants. There are short-term grants, medium-term grants, and long-term grants. So the medium for this, the small-scale grants is grants funded for 2 years. Then there are some grants funded up to 5 years, which is the thematic projects. And that there is a number of centers being funded by FAPESP that can be funded up to 11 years. And NeuroMat is one of them. So there is currently 17 of these centers being funded by FAPESP in the state of São Paulo, plus 5 centers being funded by FAPESP together with some company. So FAPESP can only fund this kind of research together with company in a more applied, more focused way. And then I'm going to talk a little bit about this medium term, the young investigators, in some minutes when I'll be concluding, because I hope I will be able to convince some of you, at least some of you that are outside from São Paulo, that it's a good idea to move to São Paulo to do research. And this is a good mechanism to bring people from abroad to come here and to make research in the state of São Paulo. There is a joke that I really like to emphasize this because it's a nice thing to talk, mainly when we are talking about from people out from outside São Paulo. When I'm talking outside from São Paulo, I'm not talking about passports. And the joke is that in FAPESP, we never look at passports. We only look at CVs. So all we are interested in good CVs, bringing good CVs to the state of São Paulo. There is something that is quite important to emphasize also in this type of talks. It regards the impact being funded by FAPESP. And this is a concept that is particularly quite important for CEPIDs. FAPESP can fund research, as I mentioned, in all domains of knowledge. So, say, literature, quantum physics, cosmology, engineering, so on and so forth. You name it, and FAPESP can fund it. And FAPESP can fund basic research and applied research. And FAPESP is mainly interested in the impact of the research that is produced by the scientists in the state of São Paulo. And by mentioning impact, I'm not talking just about impact like citations or something like this. It can be any kind of impact. The point is that it's important to try to produce relevant science in the state of São Paulo. This is the main focus. Where relevant can have different meanings and different definitions. This is quite important. Relevant can be, for instance, when we are talking about, as I mentioned, intellectual relevance. I produced a new algorithm, and I convinced my colleagues that it's a good algorithm, and people start to adopt my algorithm and citing my paper where I described it. But it could be for also a software that I produced, and everybody started to use the software. Or it could be some kind of book or whatever. These are all types of intellectual ways of gaining relevance. But it can also be social relevance, or it can be economic relevance. So all kinds of impact in FAPESP are seen as the main goal for pushing our scientists towards progressing, actually. And for CEPIDs, this is mainly relevant. This is something that when I'll be talking about the CEPIDs program that FAPESP created, I hope that you are going to understand that this is something that FAPESP pays lots of attention. But as I mentioned, in a broad sense, and this is quite important. For instance, this is the kind of research that has been carried out in Rio Claro. There is a researcher, a biologist, that is a professor at UNESP Rio Claro, that studied together with some English groups in Manchester, carbon absorption in Amazonia. And she had her research project working together with the English people. And they published a paper in Nature 2 years ago, where the cover of the Nature is actually an illustration of her work there. So this is really basic research. I mean, we're talking about carbon absorption and global climate changes and everything. I'm not sure if she will be able to fund a company based on their research, or it doesn't matter. The point is that it's a relevant relevant research that has been recognized by, for instance, Nature up to the point of bringing it to the cover of that day. So this is the kind of thing that I like to emphasize, mainly when we are talking about impact of research in a broad sense. Or there is another example. There are some laws in the state of São Paulo that has been passed by the Assembly Legislative and so on and so forth. And the law starts by saying, I'm going to translate here, it's written in Portuguese, of course, but I'm going to translate a little bit. Considering the results of the research funded by FAPESP under the process number, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, the state defines that, and then comes the law. Which means that there is some research that funded by FAPESP that now is governing our life. For instance, because there are some reserves that are preserved, ecological reserves that are preserved, and so on and so forth. So this is the kind of impact that eventually the papers that were published, they are not two-sided. But we cannot say that this kind of research does not have an impact on the society. So this is the type of things that is quite important to mention. FAPESP funds research in all domains of knowledge, but since we are talking here about I work on NeuroMat, it involves mathematics and neuroscience and other domains. I'm going to talk a little bit about physical science and engineering. Mathematics is part of this domain in FAPESP. there's a number of different fields organized in FAPESP around this theme. Let me give some examples of research funded by FAPESP in international collaborations. FAPESP, for instance, funds the creation, the building of the GMT, the Giant Magellan Telescope, which will be built in Chile. It's an international initiative, quite important international initiative to fund one of the most powerful telescopes that will be built from now until 2024-25, and FAPESP is funding some research groups here in the state of São Paulo that are part of it. Or FAPESP funds research in another different telescope called the CTA that will be built in Chile and Ilhas Canarias, Canary Islands in Africa. And this is a prototype. This is a prototype of the telescope that will be built in this. It's an array of telescopes, actually. And if you see here, this part here, this is a telescope that is a prototype that is in Berlin. And here what you see, this support is the support for the cameras that are in front, but unfortunately we cannot see it. This support here has been designed in the Institute of Physics of São Carlos and has been built by a company in São José dos Campos, everything funded by FAPESP. So we are talking about one of the most important and powerful telescopes that will be built from now to 2024, and which has a part, a fundamental part of it, that has been designed by a student, a master's student, and a supervisor that is a professor at the Institute of Physics of São Carlos, and has been built by a company in São José dos Campos. So from the most basic research, because they're interested in things like dark matter and all kinds of most fundamental things that science is doing, up to the point of funding a company that is building the supports and so on and so forth. So I'm just giving some examples to show the kind of interest and kind of results that FAPESP has been gaining up this moment. FAPESP can also fund some groups that are associated to CERN and so on and so forth. So I'm not going to jump into the details regarding these examples, but if you want, we can discuss some of them. Okay? and also sustaining pain and so on and so forth. In the fields of mathematics, this is a screenshot of FAPESP has an online database. By the way, this is an important issue regarding NeuroMat too, because NeuroMat is interested in open data, right? And providing open source of information and publicizing things and so on and so forth. FAPESP has a public library online called the BV, the Virtual Library, which has all projects funded by FAPESP since 1992 online. So you can, if you search for it, you can look for people that are doing something that you're interested, for instance, who are the professors that are working on, say, some different kind of Markovian models and so on and so forth. You can look for different groups or projects, and then you're going to find the groups, the researchers, the students, the abstracts, the titles, and so on and so forth. So it's a quite complete library that is provided online. And particularly, this is a screenshot of the fields of mathematics, which gives a little bit an idea of the mathematicians doing research in the state of São Paulo. As you can see, there is, for instance, currently 226 different grants being funded by FAPESP. And up to the moment, FAPESP funded 10,000 different scholarships and grants in the fields of mathematics. This is the distribution of the mathematics grants in the state of São Paulo. You can recognize here São Paulo, Campinas, São Carlos, which are important large hubs, plus a number of different locations that have mathematicians doing research and gaining some kind of support from FAPESP. This is just to conclude this general part about the research being funded by FAPESP. To conclude, I'm showing here a kind of set of covers. All these covers, since we're among mathematicians or people that at least know how to talk to mathematicians, so either we have mathematicians or people that know how to talk to mathematicians here, which is not always the case. And since I come from the Institute of Mathematics, I know what I'm talking about. This is a set of covers of different journals. You may recognize some of these journals. And the common property among all these journals here, these numbers, is that there is a research funded by FAPESP in that number, and the paper published there became the cover of the journal. So these are all, if you see here, these are all covers of associated to papers that have been funded by FAPESP in some way in different domains. Okay, now I'm going to conclude. Before going to the part of talking about the CPIDs, I would like to talk a little bit about applied research. So up to now, I've talked much more about general research and basic research, like mathematics, biology, and so on, ecology, and so on and so forth. As I mentioned, FAPESP can fund research, either fund research in a company, or together with a company in a research institution. So there are the two different models. If FAPESP is going to fund the research in a company, so in this case, it must be a small business, a small company, which by the Brazilian definition, it's a company up to 250 employees. So it's for many countries, it's a medium-sized company. This is what we call the PP program. And the main constraint is that the applicant, the researcher that is applying, must be a researcher that is going to develop the project in the company. So this is the main aspect that has. I would like to show some examples of research that was funded by FAPESP or is currently being funded by FAPESP that produced, in this case, some kind of impact, but economic impact in some terms or something like this. This is a company, again, that has been funded by FAPESP and that is located in São José dos Campos. This company produces these balloons that you are seeing here. And these are surveillance balloons, which means that they can stay flying. And they have a set of cameras, a set of different sensors that are able to do different kind of imaging about where they're doing their surveillance systems. So they have different sensors. And these kind of balloons, they have lots of good properties. They can stay for nearly 1 week or something like this flying without the need of any maintenance or something like this. They have different types of cameras. They have infrared cameras, high resolution cameras, and so on and so forth. They're quite easy to move and to spot in different things. So it means that they have different applications. And I'm talking about this example here, which, is, as I mentioned, was initially funded by FAPESP, because during the Olympics games that we just ended some 2 months ago or something like this in Rio de Janeiro, this company was selected by the government to do the surveillance of the different Olympics spots in Rio de Janeiro. So they placed 4 of these balloons. By the way, these are bulletproof balloons. So if you take a look at the demo, there are some, I don't remember if this is the demo or not, but if you go to the website or YouTube, they have some demos where they are firing with different guns in the balloons and the balloon stays without exploding or something like this. And so they were the company responsible for producing this kind of images during the Olympics games for the security system that was provided by the government, and in a contract of 27 million reais, just for that spot. So it's, again, an example where to do the selection, they had a competition, and they were competing against people, companies from Israel, from France, from different places, and this small business that is started as a small business funded by FAPESP won the competition, and then they have this nice result. Well, for instance, the explanation that I mentioned regarding the Olympics games. This is another example. These are wheelchairs that have been designed in the Faculdade de Engenharia Elétrica, the Electrical Engineering Institute in Unicamp, Campinas. And this is a wheelchair that is guided, controlled by face expressions, actually. So again, it's a company, it's a couple of students from Unicamp that designed the wheelchair and then founded the company. And in a partnership with Unicamp, and now they are doing different applications doing this this technology. Again, let me see if I can. Yes, FAPESP created quite another example of different fields of applications that FAPESP worked is the Zika virus, the Zika network that FAPESP created. In order to do research regarding the Zika virus that you have heard during the last 1 year or something like this. So this is another example of applied research funded by FAPESP for different kind of impact, social impacts. And then the last example I'm going to show you, there is a company in Botucatu that has been funded by FAPESP that they produce this kind of device. It's a device for physiotherapy. It produces small kind of controlled electric shocks to do muscle recovery and this kind of stuff. And this is a company that has been funded initially by FAPESP. If you go to a drugstore, a pharmacy here in São Paulo, for instance, you can find this product. It's called Tanix, and particularly is the one that he used by Neymar. So this photo I took from the company's webpage, and you can see Neymar here, and then he's using actually one of that devices. As I mentioned, was produced initially as a project funded by FAPESP. I'm going to conclude this part in order to show 2 maps. So this is the first map that I showed in the beginning of the talk, where you can see the scholarships funded by FAPESP in all domains of knowledge, as I mentioned. Some of the scholarships are maybe seated actually in this class, in this room today. And this is a map of the companies being funded by FAPESP. And what you see here is a large correlation. And this is a message that we like to stress, mainly for people that do not understand the kinds of byproducts that we have. The main message that we want to show here is that you start funding research, basic research, applied research, what type of research you want, then high-tech companies, they start to appear. even if eventually they are not associated to the research that we are funding. This is quite important. It's an important argument to show to society, actually. So I'm going to talk a little bit now about the CEPIDs. So it's the last part of the talk. And now focus on the intellectual impact. I'm talking about different kinds of impacts. Now I'm going to move to not talk to about CEPIDs regarding intellectual impact. This is a map of the, you can see a map of the world and the different countries. And this is a good, actually it's a good exercise for people that likes to use this kind of different optimization algorithms. The optimization algorithm that run here, it created each country is proportional to the number of citations of the papers published by that country. So this is a map of the world that shows if you measure impact in terms of citations. This is a map of world citations, actually, regarding the different countries. And the kind of message that it has been published in a paper in Nature 2012, and the kind of message that we show here is that if impact in this sense is a kind of party, as my 18 years old daughter likes to say, the popular people, they are not here in the South Hemisphere. This is the point. Science that is being produced in this sense and the way people are interacting and doing research and producing papers and citing and creating partnerships and whatever you want, they're really concentrated on these parts here. And this is the kind of challenge that FAPESP would like to address, actually. And CEPIDs is one of the main mechanisms. By creating these kind of things that you are doing here, partnerships between researchers here in the state of São Paulo and researchers in France and researchers in Italy and bringing people from Japan to here and bringing students from here to anywhere else. There is a top group doing research in some place. These are the mechanisms that FAPESP have been putting lots of efforts in order to address this kind of problem. Otherwise, this is a kind of map of irrelevance, actually. And this is the kind of things that we would like to address. In order to do this, FAPESP has different mechanisms. FAPESP has lots of international agreements, for instance. Currently, FAPESP has more than 120 new different agreements. There are different calls. Maybe you are part of one of these projects. I do not suppose you are going to be able to read all these fonts here, but these are all institutions that have some partnership together with FAPESP, either in Europe, you are seeing here, either in the US here, and also in some other places in the country. Here is just a zoom for this about the institutions in the US that FAPESP has different agreements. Here's a kind of zoom that we have in Europe. So these are some of the mechanisms that FAPESP have been trying to use to implement tools in order to address the challenge that I just mentioned previously. And there is an additional way of doing this is by means of the scholarships that are funded by FAPESP. As you know, the scholarships funded by FAPESP, they have the possibility of the student to do part of his or her research abroad, any place doing good science anywhere in the world. This is a map of scholarship holders being funded by FAPESP and doing part of his or her research somewhere in the world. So you can see there are people being funded by FAPESP anywhere. Some of these people may be in France or any place that you can recognize here. Now I'm going to conclude talking about the specific topic of the research centers. The research centers is one of the main programs that FAPESP created, as you know. This is the second phase. So there is one that there was a call in 2000. FAPESP funded at that time 10 research centers. And then there was a different call in 2011. And then in this case, there were 138 applications. And FAPESP selected 17. And NeuroMat is one of them. So this is what brought us here in this room in this afternoon. As I mentioned, there are 17 of these centers. If you're interested, I can talk about any details regarding them, but I'm going to focus mainly on the centers that are linked to mathematics or computer science or something, since I suppose this is a common ground for people in this room here. But if you want, I can talk to different, there are centers in all domains. There are centers in biology, in medicine, in social sciences, in urban science. So it's a good portfolio of centers. The CEPIDs, they have been selected with a number of ideas in the code that has been designed in order to cover the applications. So the first thing, it's supposed, the CEPIDs are supposed to address big and complex challenges, which means that you need a good set of researchers and students to address that problem, or those problems. And in principle, they are supposed to be problems that cannot be addressed by either a small set of people or too much focused set of people or in a small interval of time. This is quite important. That's what we are talking about, really challenge research that can produce relevant and impact results during the existence. There is another aspect that is quite important in this mechanism, is that since the centers can be funded up to 11 years, this means that the researchers, the director, the governance board, etc., they are able to do long-term planning and to adapt themselves along the years. This is quite important, without the need of applying for a different grant and running for different grant applications and so on and so forth. So this gives lots of flexibility on the hands of the people that are taking decisions about how the center is run. So this is quite a quite important thing regarding the centers. And this is totally different between the CEPIDs and all other grants that FAPESP funds. It's important to understand that. But of course, as Uncle John, which is the uncle of Peter Parker, would say, with great power comes great responsibilities, right?
And lots of
reports. Yeah. So the research can be funded up to 11 years. The CEPIDs, the centers, are supposed to carry activities around three different axes: research, innovation, and dissemination. Innovation and dissemination, as you know, understand, they should be understood in quite broad sense, after all that I tried to show from the start here. We're talking about centers that should become international excellent, in the sense that we think about international excellence in all domains that we work. There is something that FAPESP tries to push quite strong, is the institutional support. These centers, the idea here is that we that are scientists, we are supposed to do science. And other things that are not exactly science, the institution should provide the means for doing that, so that we can focus on the science and someone else is doing different things. It's quite important. This is the main, I guess this is the main thing that we're thinking about when we're talking about support, institutional support. And FAPESP has been pushing a lot and discussing a lot with institutions, as you know, in order to provide, so that institution can provide you with this support, institutional support. And as part of the mechanism to help the centers progress in the direction that I mentioned, FAPESP has set an international committee that was responsible for this initial selection of the centers, as I mentioned. It was a quite competitive call. We are talking about nearly 150 applications for 16 or 11 centers that have been selected. And this group is responsible for the initial selection and is responsible for following the activities of the centers. Takeaway message. So there is something that it's quite important. Now I'm talking about the centers and you that are responsible for this center, NeuroMat in particular. This is quite important. The centers are not supposed to be a set of good, smaller size, independent projects. Because Otherwise, since we're talking about a competition, 150 good applications, selecting 17 good applications, of course we have good science at the other end. And of course we have good science that would be able to produce medium-sized projects, because they have been doing this for 30 years or 40 years now. So the center should be something different from a set of independent medium-sized projects where people are simply doing what they were doing before being put in the denomination of a center. So this is quite important. This is a key issue. In this case, what FAPESP and the International Committee thinks is quite important is that the center defines missions, should have a clear mission, and then should show to FAPESP, to the society, to the committee, to the reviewers, that they are working towards the mission they define it themselves. This is the point. The center can define any mission. Of course, they define it there from the beginning. But then they should show that people are trying to do everything they can towards that mission. So this is a key issue regarding the center's governance, the center's evaluation, and so on and so forth. And of course, to do this, it's quite fundamental, the governance that we have in the center. Otherwise, I'm a scientist, I'm in a computer science department, I'm in the Institute of Mathematics, I'm in the University of São Paulo. I know that everybody will have a really strong force towards entropy. It's really, everyone is willing to do what he or she wants to do, and do not want to anyone come in and say, no, you should not do this, you should do that, and so on and so forth. So in order to accomplish the mission, because we're talking about a difficult, complex challenge, then we have to have the governance of the center remembering everybody that we have a mission, we would like to accomplish that mission. There are some different aspects regarding the center that are quite key for the centers to be working. So there is the governance that I mentioned. There is, in general, the director. There is a board that helps to take the decisions. There is supposed to be a manager, executive manager, that helps to execute everything that we are talking about. Then there are the key axes that I mentioned, research, innovation, and dissemination, particularly for these two aspects here. Each center has a coordinator who is a professor, a PI, that is responsible for something. And then there is someone from the university, provided by the university, helping this professor, this coordinator to accomplish his duties. The centers should have an international advisory board that helps the center to evaluate things, find opportunities, find out what is not working, find out what is working, and so on and so forth. Kind of really taking this kind of role regarding the center. And finally, the international links. Different types of international links are supposed to be carried out by the center. Maybe you are just talking, what is Roberto talking about? There are French people here, Italian people here, people. Maybe I'm just what we say in Portuguese, chovendo no molhado. But it's quite important to emphasize this from time to time.
Well, maybe mathematicians are more international than other fields. Our seminar probably has been made in English in the last 50 years. And now São Paulo, they just say you must do it in English. I would like to say it in English because, well, Eva does not speak Portuguese.
Okay. That's great. There are some different FAPESP. The way, and now I'm talking, if you want, we can start talking about different ways of improving the program. But then I think about looking at different centers running is that we can try to grasp good ideas that are being led by some centers that could be adopted by the others. So this is an important thing, and I'm totally free to discuss any aspect regarding this, because maybe this can bring some good ideas for you, for NeuroMat. In particular, regarding these international links, some of the effort, strong effort that are being paid by the different centers include, is not limited to this, but includes attracting young researchers, as I mentioned, and FAPESP has a program for that. So again, we're not talking about passports, because this is something that people start saying, oh, but FAPESP has the requirement that the postdoc must be non-Brazilian. No, there's nothing about this written anywhere. As I mentioned, FAPESP does not look at passports or visas or anything like this. It must be a good CV that has experience somewhere in the world, that knows how those people that are doing the science party around the world, how does that work, and we would like to have young researchers bring this experience to here. So this is quite important. FAPESP has some mechanism in order to attract senior research to the state, so either moving here or leading research here. I'm going to talk a little bit about that. And some centers are doing a lot of this. For instance, putting some of these senior researchers in the international advisory board. So this is a good way of having advice from these people. And there are some centers that are doing something that I'm not sure if NeuroMat is doing that, but then since it's a good experience from what we have been following different centers, there are some centers that they have. It's not a way of inviting sometime someone. They have a program. They have made a plan. Like, the main journals in our field are these. So they have a map of where our people are publishing around the world. And then they start inviting, in a systematic way, people from those journals to come to the center. Editor-in-chief, editorial board, leader of this, leader of that. But in a long-term way, we're talking about every year we are going to have 3 or 4 editors-in-chief or editorial board member or something like this visiting the center. And since we are talking about, I don't know, a dozen people or something like this, you cannot invite all of a sudden everybody. So you have to have a long-term planning for these kind of things. Another thing that I forgot to put here, finding similar centers around the world and having a planning to have some contact to them. For instance, inviting the different directors of those centers to come to the center so that they can talk about their difficulties, the problems they had, their experience, what is working, what is not working, eventually creating new partnerships. So these centers, they are doing this kind of stuff too, also to similar centers around the world. And of course, you know who are these people. You are who are the journals, you are who are the professors, you know who are the centers. This is a good thing that some centers, they are, as I mentioned, it's not a random thing. It's a plan for 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, or something like this.
For instance, in our international advisory board, we have David Billinger, who is the first person who started looking at interaction graphs for neurons in the 60s. We have Wojtek Spankowski, who is the director of a CEPID in the United States, who came here. And of course, it was very important for discuss to him what the kind of experience. We have Leonard Cohen from NIH, who is one of the main names in plasticity, who also visited us. So we have been trying to do this in the same way. I never thought about inviting journal editors, except the one who we work with. How can I justify it for FAPESP?
In general, these people are researchers somewhere. He makes a talk and he interacts with his students and he interacts with FAPESP has doing. You have been hearing this news. I mean, FAPESP has been doing this for many years now. The editors of Nature, editor of Science.
So Joel Lebovitz visited us because he's an important member of our community and he's the editor founder of Journal of Astrophysics, Pierre Collet. Who is my most important co-author, was the editor of Alain Stuart Poincaré, and so on. So I have to do it in an indirect way, but a good idea.
And there's an additional byproduct, because by doing this, the center, in an additional new way, becomes a hub. Because if the editor-in-chief of the Journal of Statistical Analysis, something from somewhere comes, of course it will be interested by the centers. But there are many people in São Paulo in the state of São Paulo, that would be interested to see a talk about him. He or she does not work on neuroscience and mathematics. He works on different fields of statistics, but he or she would be interested. And it's a way of bringing these people to know NeuroMat and to talk on NeuroMat.
That's a very good
idea. Some centers are doing this with quite good positive results, actually.
Very good idea.
And partnerships, as I mentioned. Yes. I'm going to conclude to talk about the centers, because I talked too much already. So as I mentioned, there are three centers that are really, they have mathematics, computer science, plus something. So these are, this is the selection criteria that I use to select these three. This is the only selection criteria. So there is CMAI, which is the Center for Mathematics in Industry.
Cominato.
Yes, hosted at São Carlos by Poti, by José Cominato. But there are researchers from here, from Instituto of Mathematics, that are part of it, from Unicamp and so on and so forth. Probably you know many of these people. So they're basically looking for good opportunities of research linking mathematical problems in industry and their expertise to solve mathematical problems. There is the Center for Computational Engineering and Sciences at Unicamp, who does lots of data science and e-science, which is also something quite important in NeuroMat. This center is hosted by the Faculdade de Engenharia Mecânica, Mechanical Engineering Institute of the University of Campinas. By the way, since you from time to time we talk about data sets and databases, and I know this is one of the goals that you have, they have a quite good experience, which is this database that they created together with the Institute for Brain, the Brain Institute, the Brain CEPID, that are actually collecting different types of data. It's the BIPMED initiative, maybe you already heard about it. They're hosting the center, they're hosting the infrastructure, and then the CEPIDs are producing the data, because Brain in Unicamp produces data regarding, I don't know, epilepsy and different kinds of brain injuries and so on and so forth. Mayana produces genomic data about stem cells and different things. Other centers, the Center for Obesity in Campinas produces data associated to obesity, diabetes, and so on and so forth. But all these centers, they're following the same protocol to make the data available. And they are unifying this thing. And apparently, they are already reaching lots of results, because they are calling the attention of different groups around the world that are now using their system in order to look for the data that those CEPIDs they are creating. So this is a quite good experience. And we had a meeting 2 weeks ago with lots of people saying really good things about this initiative of sharing the data, in this case, sharing the data that is produced by different centers. It's not they are not producing this data. They're organizing the data that is produced by different people. And finally, NeuroMat, I do not have to say. You're talking a lot about NeuroMat these days. But this is the third center that we have. I'm going to conclude about the three. I started talking about the different opportunities to bring people to the state of São Paulo. FAPESP has paid lots of efforts in order to bring people here. You are some of the invited people that come because of these kind of initiatives. So FAPESP has scholarships. It's by far the best scholarship we have in the country. Lots of good aspects regarding the duration, the value, the opportunity for the research, the student to go to abroad, to do part of the research abroad, to think and to plan about the career, and so on and so forth. So these are the postdoctoral scholarships. FAPESP has a grant called the Young Investigator. The idea here is to look for people that is doing or has done recently a postdoc in a good center in his or her domain around the world and is willing to move to São Paulo. So the two main constraints in this kind of grant of FAPESP is the researcher did a postdoc in a good center around the world and has a good CV. So these are the two main constraints. If you know someone that has these two constraints, that obeys these two constraints, and is willing to come to São Paulo, this can be a good mechanism. FAPESP can fund up to 4 years. Now, in truth, in reality, this has been changed. It can be elongated to up to 5 years, actually. And there is a scholarship. So if this guy, this researcher, came to São Paulo and the university is not paying for the salary, FAPESP will pay for the salary. Eventually, this guy has been hired by the university. In this case, FAPESP will not pay the scholarship, will pay everything else. So there are the two models, they're possible. And FAPESP in this case can fund consumables, scholarships, everything that that is required for the research. And finally, this is my last talk, my last slide. FAPESP has a program called the São Paulo Excellence Chair. The idea in this case is that if there is a senior research, someone well recognized, a successful research, working any place around the world, and is willing to cooperate here in the state of São Paulo by starting a project, so FAPESP can fund this researcher up to 5 years. It's equivalent to what we call the thematic project. FAPESP can fund this researcher up to 5 years so that he or she can start the project here. In this case, there is a single constraint. There is the CV constraint, which is the stronger, as I mentioned. We are talking about top scientists. The constraint is that the researcher should spend at least at least 3 months per year working here in the state of São Paulo. It does not have to be contiguous. So it can be, for instance, 3 visits of 1 month. It can be 12 visits of 1 week. You can think about any kind of, of combination you want. The point is that 3 months per year, this researcher is here working on this project. And in this case, FAPESP will pay for everything, as I mentioned. Equipment, scholarships, consumables, except for the salary. The university will pay the salary about of these 3 months. And there are some good results that FAPESP has been obtaining regarding this. For instance, to give an example in physics, there is the graphene. Maybe you already heard about the graphene center at Mackenzie University. It's a Brazilian physicist called Antonio de Castro Neto, who is a professor at the Singapore University. He's a leader on his field in graphene, and he started the center at Mackenzie. In this case, Mackenzie provided the building. So FAPESP really built a building where McGrath is now located. FAPESP is paying for everything else, and Antonio Helio comes to São Paulo 3 months per year, as I mentioned, to do the research here. So as I mentioned, there are from the young researcher to the senior research opportunity. It's really a matter of us to organize ourselves to find those people. As Galvis, I would be able to talk for hours. Okay? For you. I'm going to spare from that experience. Thank you very much.
Abroad, isn't it?
What is senior? What is senior?
Senior, for example, for me, I'm a senior. To go to London, for example, for 1 year, it's possible?
No, FAPESP does not fund postdocs abroad for the whole project. If someone is a postdoc in the state of São Paulo, this researcher can apply for additional grant called the BEPI scholarship. And this researcher can develop part of the research project abroad up to 1 year.
Yes.
So this is the model that FAPESP fund. FAPESP can fund researchers, in this case not scholarship holders, postdocs, but researchers from the state of São Paulo that is living for a kind of sabbatical from 3 months. 3 months up to from some few weeks up to 3 months up to 1 year.
Yeah.
But then in this case we're talking about something analogous to a sabbatical or something like this. There are different constraints regarding that, but this is also possible.
Okay.
I don't know if this was the.
Okay. Okay. Imperial College.
Every time we have a general meeting of the project, I invite Roberto and Brito to come here. I think it's important to have this Well, we have opportunities to meet every day because we have the same institute, but it's different. And so, so maybe we should thank Roberto and go to have some coffee.
Okay, so I will start this last session of the day and just starting to present myself. I'm Renan Shimoura. I'm working with Professor Roque in Ribeirão Preto. I started my PhD something like 3-4 months ago. So what I will show is just some preliminary results and tests that I made with the cortical microcircuit model that was already mentioned by Roque and Newton. And in different scenarios, just 2 scenarios that I will explain, and with a synaptic plasticity rule that I will explain later too. So for the introduction, just 3 important informations to understand how I model my network. First of them is the already mentioned that cortex, new cortex can be divided in different layers. So again, you can have to divide in 6 different layers. Each layer have different numbers of neurons and different types of neurons that can respond to an input in different manner. And beside of that, now of the regions of the new cortex, we have these different 6 layers. But specifically, I will talk about I will take a characteristic from the primary visual cortex that there are some neurons in primary visual cortex that if you show, for example, to an animal a bar in the horizontal way, some neurons will respond in the optimized way. So if I change this orientation of the bar to 90 degree, so another neurons in the region will respond better than the others. So this is one characteristic that I will put in the model. And another thing is that the synaptic plasticity, as we know, was mentioned in other talks, is important. It's thought to be underlying mechanism of learning and maintenance of memory, etc. And another question is how the synaptic plasticity changes, for example, the neurons, the orientation selectivity of these neurons, for example, in development for other layers. So just to start, this is the question that I already told you. How this synaptic plasticity will change the orientation selectivity of the network. When I say network, I will measure of each neuron and make an index and compare how it changes. And just to understand the method, and starting with the network. The network is the same network that Roque mentioned, the Newton mentioned too. It's based on the Potion's Disman paper. So we have 4 layers. We have excitatory populations and inhibitory populations of neurons in each layer. For the 2 scenarios that I mentioned, that I will do in my protocols, the first one is the same as Newton presented, with a Poisson noise, Poisson background in all neurons with 8 hertz. And for the second, I will give to the network for the neurons of layer 4 inputs, like pulses of inputs with orientated angles. For example, I can put an input here with that represents a bar with 90 degrees. But I will explain better. So another detail is that I'm not using the 8,000 neurons in that simulation. That, as I told you, just some preliminary results. So I'm optimizing the code. So I did just only not small, but 10,000 neurons with approximately 5 million of synapses. Okay, so the model, what we have been calling Gauss and Loscherbaum model, but it's the version of the paper of Ludmila. But as Roque explained to you, what we did was adjusting some parameters of the equations to obtain a regular spiking of the neuron like that. For example, we have the Z-cavity model spiking with a constant input, a constant current, and here's the GL model. So another thing that is important, as I mentioned, I am working with a synaptic plasticity rule. And what this rule will change is this term, this W here, that is the synaptic strain between two neurons. And this synaptic increment, just to say, if the presynaptic is inhibitory, so it will have a negative value and positive for excitatory neurons. So the synaptic plasticity rule that I started using was the STDP, that the spike time dependent plasticity. We can remember for the Hebbian plasticity that if you have two neurons and these neurons spikes in the, for example, a window of time, you can have a change in the synaptic weight. But for this rule, the time matters. So if the presynaptic neuron, the first one here, so if the presynaptic neuron fires first, and after you have the postsynaptic, so the synaptic weight will be strengthening, and the opposite will be depressed. This if these two events occurs in the window of time that I can determine in the model. So the protocols that I used in the in these simulations, as I mentioned, I used two protocols. The first one with Poissonian spike trains applied in now neurons as background with 8 hertz. And the second one, trying to mimic a visual stimulus. As I said, I just simulating an cortical networks. So for implement this kind of stimulus, I just try to explain. For example, just backing to explain what I am trying to say. For example, if I take just one neuron, and this one neuron, I give for it an input of a different orientation, so it will respond better to just one orientation, but will respond to another not with so high frequency as the angle that is preferred for him. So I put by hand in all neurons of layer 4 excitators, I put a preference angle. So for example, if I have 1,000 of neurons in layer 4 excitators, I divided it in groups, and I say, oh, this first group will respond preferentially to the 90 degrees, and goes on. 0 to 180 degrees.
You did it in arbitrary way.
Yeah, no, the net was constructed in arbitrary way because I have a random test. So I just take the index, the first index, and I put an angle. And but is that? Oh, this is an important fact, because if I'm looking for different species, I can have a column, and the neurons that respond to 90 degrees will be located vertically, very close to each other neurons, like a microcolumn. But if I'm looking to another animals, like in rats, this is not so spatially spaced. It's like what they call the salt and pepper. So it's mixed, like randomly mixed. And what is important is the functional groups that is responding to the stimulus. So I don't have the horizontal, how can I say it? I don't have the horizontal, Yes, it's not topographic in the horizontal way, just in the vertical. So just explaining, so I have this kind of neurons that respond better just in layer 4. That's the main input of the thalamus. And in the other neurons, I didn't put this thing. And what I did was, for example, I did 9 simulations. The first simulation with 0 degree. So the 0 degree, I put the an input with this angle, and I see how the network achieved change or how it will what was the behavior in time, and I did it to like I said 9 times. And what I use it to measure if the neuron is more selective to the angle, to this input, was this OSI, this orientation selectivity index. And basically, if it is 0, the neuron fires for any stimuli. So if I put any angle, this neuron will fire. And if this index gives me the measure close to 1, so the neuron fires preferentially to 1 angle. So just an index that I use to take a histogram of all the neurons of the network, just to have a global view. So the preliminary results, first of that, the first protocol that was similar to the Newton. The stimulus enter like a cosine. So I have, for example, I have a group of neurons that this theta is star. Yeah. But had a frequency of 2 hertz. I put in every 0.5 seconds. I put a pulse with a small duration. For the first protocol, this is the same, not the same exactly, but it's the same situation of the simulation of Newton. But here I have just 10,000 of neurons comparing the Newton, that is 80,000. And here, just looking at the graph, is I don't know if I can say that, but qualitatively speaking, is more asynchronous and irregular than the other network. So this is with the GL model. So I can't see the bands in that network, not in this situation. And here's the frequency that is pretty much this, not the same, but follows the same profile. So I have the inhibitory layers, the inhibitory populations are higher than the excitatory populations. And here, just what changes in the network, in the activity of the network with the STDP. And just another detail that I forgot to say, sorry for that. But the STDP that I use until now is just an STDP. This is a plasticity between excitatory connections. So this is very important to know. It's just to excitatory connections. So some artifacts can happen because of that. So there are another models that can balance this. But what is good here that we can actually see some effects that can be important or not, but can... No, it's just a synaptic plasticity. It's not a structural plasticity. So, yes, can. Yes, in some layers the frequency increase, but in other layers the frequency decreases too. So, it's not so simple dynamic, but the higher frequencies can be explained by this. So if I put, for example, a plasticity in inhibitor to excitator, probably you balance this, and I will maybe have frequencies that are not so higher like that.
Why did you put also plasticity
inhibitor? Because just to try to follow the steps and see what specifically this kind of STDP can tell me, and after put the other STDPs and put together, and if it matches, if the conclusions matches, I. To STDP?
Yes.
This is the way the STDP, what's the behavior? Actually, you have, for example, two. Yes, this exponential is decay.
You
need to, in that module, you need to put a limit. So you need to put an upper body. Yes, I have a limit. STDP.
Too
many letters. Okay. Yeah, please.
Yeah, just to mention that this work, I think it's exactly this work from Song, where they show that if you put that the area of the depression part is larger than the... Exactly.
Yes, you can,
then you have a homeostatic mechanism that prevents this explosion of the weights,
and
just by doing this.
The distribution will be not bimodal, but less bimodal in the synaptic weights.
What makes it
because
unimodal.
Because what happens here is still bimodal, but not totally bimodal. It's just a bimodal that you have the bounds, and it's like that. So.
Yeah, so it's a long time since I read that paper. I don't remember the details. But I think, if I'm not wrong, that it was bimodal as long as the amount of increase does not depend on the weight itself.
Okay.
If you put that dependence, then you get a unimodal.
But I'm
not sure of that. But,
if I change that, it's still bimodal?
Yeah. If you put more depression than excitation, with this you prevent the explosion of the weights. You reach a stationary...
But it's still bimodal.
But it's still bimodal. Yeah.
No, because I think that's important because... here I didn't see an explosion, and I used the same symmetry. In that case, I used it for the first test. I used symmetric and didn't explode.
Ah, okay.
Okay, sorry. Okay. But
yeah, maybe
thank
we
you.
Can we can continue.
No. It's, okay.
I do not understand why you cannot see the stimulus here.
This is the Poissonian. This is the first protocol, yes.
So you show now one with...
Yes. I have the if you, I have in the final of the presentation. I can just... I put this. Yes, this is the... For example, I think it's 180 degrees. What matters is that these neurons here, these neurons with this index, are responding in an optimized way to the input that I put in this example. This is just one example of just one angle. So every time that I put these neurons respond in a higher frequency.
Inhibit the others?
Yeah, inhibit the others that actually excites the inhibitors that inhibit the others. So I think it's something like that, which happens in that neurons in the layer 4. Because with the plasticity, and as the plasticity is only just excitator to excitator, that didn't happen here. But what I saw in the, we can see here, is that for upper layers and the layers, yes, you can see that it becomes more selective to the oriented bar, because it's more, just qualitatively speaking, because it's more clear to see the how the inputs are active in the network.
But still, you can see that the dark becomes darker for the light in layer 4.
Yes. I'm saying just because of the graph here, and maybe the computer is better to see. Okay, so just was an additional picture, sorry. Just coming back. And as I mentioned, the index that I calculate, and I calculate this for each neuron, and I made a histogram. So the red part of the graph, of the histograms, just to mention, this is 0 to 1. So the red part of the histogram, these are the neurons that the selectivity index are higher than 0.5. So just to make it easier to see. And with, for example, for layer 2 and 3, if I put the synaptic plasticity, this is the percentage of neurons in red. So it increases a lot. So I can see that the distribution of this index change, this is the count, but the distribution change and become more selectivity. So the network is becoming more, how can I say? It's more, selective to the untamed bars. So the same we can see for the other layers. So basically, is that. So for layer 5 and layer 6, you can see how have an increase in this part of the graph. So for this preliminary results, basically is that.
Layer five,
yes. Yeah, the 0 to 20%. So.
Does that make sense? Layer 5.
I mean, and then in layer 6, you have a lot of oriented cells.
Yeah.
Layer 5 is the output.
Layer 5 is the output.
More or less.
The output to V2 is layer 2, 3.
Well, okay, I'm finished. So, special conclusion, as I mentioned, is that we see the higher frequencies in some layers. In the average, frequency was higher than without STDP, and they improve in the orientation selectivity in the networks. So, thank you. It was
okay, thank you. So my name is Rodrigo Pena. I'm a PhD candidate, and I've been working under supervision of Professor Antonio Roque, and also as co-supervision of Professor Misha Zaks, who happens to be watching us right now. I invited him. Hi, Misha. I hope so. Okay. And today I'll be presenting this talk about noise-induced transition from sleep to a wake-like state in a spiking network model, which is the work that I developed when I was in Germany working under his supervision. Okay, so as Professor Antonio Roque showed to us, we have different brain states. And in my work, I'm quite interested in describing transitions between brain states. And specifically, these two brain states, like sleep, for example, slow wave sleeps or anesthesia. If you observe the neurons, you can see that they are fluctuating between different voltage plateaus. So you can see, for example, periods where the neuron is very close to the threshold and it's spiking a lot at higher frequencies. And on other times, you see that the neurons, they are somehow quiescent. They are on this down state where it's very unlikely to observe spikings. And if you have a look at the network here, you see that the network displays oscillations. So on the other side, when we speak about awake state, I'm quite interested on patterns like this, where you see that the neurons there are spiking somehow. They are weakly correlated. They are in this asynchronous and irregular state. And I will be interested on transitions between these two different states here. Oh, sorry. So we've started this work a few years ago, and I'm not going into details of the setup and the models, but rather the mechanisms that we have observed. But shortly, we worked with Isikevichi model. It's two differential couple equations that when you integrate these equations, you can observe different spiking patterns, or the so-called electrophysiological classes. When we couple these neurons in a random setup, a random network, and then Erdős-Reinyi network, yes. The network at the beginning is at the resting state, but then if you successively deliver some inputs, you just deliver some input and then you take it out with the right combination of excitation and inhibition, you can get those oscillation patterns here. So this was work that we have published in 2014. We have really described the different types of patterns that we can obtain. It's not only oscillatory pattern, but here I will be talking about this yellow region here where we see these oscillatory patterns. So one of the features that maybe it's nice to comment here is that we observe something called as transient chaos. So you deliver an input and you take it out. So the network is self-sustained for a certain period. But then this self-sustaining, it's rather chaotic, but it's transient because it will die at some point. And there is a high sensitivity dependence on the initial conditions. So for example, on these two simulations here, they are identical simulations. All the initial conditions and seeds are the same. But the only difference between the first and the second one is that I artificially remove one single spike on this simulation. And because of that, the behavior here is completely different. I can actually break the continuity of activity here. So this brings to us a notion of chaos, but also a notion of transient chaos on this type of network. But then at some point it came to us that neurons, they are rather stochastic. So we have been speaking about that a lot here in this workshop. And you have a lot of sources of stochasticity. And I am quite interested on the source of what we call synaptic noise. So if you observe a presynaptic neuron and the postsynaptic neuron, for example, we know that there are some spontaneous release of vesicles, spontaneous release of neuron transmitters, what people call minis or mini EPSPs. And these fluctuations they are seen as noise. And also, you can have unreliability of synapses. Sometimes a presynaptic neuron emits a spike, and that's not transmitted to the postsynaptic neuron. All of that together can be seen as a source of noise, synaptic noise. And we can actually model that. There are standard models for that. For example, there is a model called point conductance model described by Destaxe. So basically, on the conductance, the excitatory and inhibitory conductance of the neurons, which are actually the synapses, you start to include Gaussian processes. So this will give a notion of a spontaneous release of these mini EPSPs and also of unreliability of synapses. It will cause some noise, some fluctuations. And when we did that, instead of stimulating the network, we leave the network work with this source of noise here. What we observed was quite surprising to us, because previously we had observed oscillations like that, but they ended at some point. And now if you leave the network working with this source of noise, we started to observe transitions of different states. Sometimes you have, maybe you cannot see here because of the slide, but you can see on the average potential here, there are spikes coming and from time to time here, and the voltage is very close to the resting potential. And at some point, then there is some sort of recruitment of neurons, and then the network starts to oscillate in a sort of sleep-like state. And then there is a transition again, and we go to this sort of awake-like state, where the network is close to the resting state. And this behavior of transition comes and goes in a rather stochastic way. So we were, at this point, very interested in trying to describe why these transitions are happening and what are the parameters that can change this type of transitions. Okay, so one of the parameters is actually the amplitude of the noise. So what would happen if you start to increase the noise, or if you start to decrease, because this actually happens in the brain. The brain sometimes have higher frequencies of spontaneous minis or lower frequencies of liberation of these minis. So we started to count the time spent for the network on these different states, which awake-like or sleep-like state. And we can average that on a long simulation, and then we have something that we call the resilience time on each of these states. And we can see how this resilience time on each of these states change due to the amplitude of noise. And what we observe is actually that the noise can influence the transitions here a lot. So, for example, these black and red curves are networks. It's the resilience time of the awake state. So it's this state here. So if you have low noise amplitudes, you observe that the network spends a lot of time on the awake state. And if you start to increase the noise, this awake state starts to get decreased, and you increase the time spent for the network in the sleep-like state. And we thought that this could actually be used by the brain. If you think that there is something like that happening in a network, maybe the brain can take advantage of that. And when we started to dig into the literature, it was quite surprising that we found some facts that could be related to that. For example, if you imagine that you are sleeping a few hours and you want to awake. So according to my curves, to our curves, if you want to awake someone that is spending times of sleep, these are the red and blue curves here, you would actually make lower the amplitude of noise, because then the resilience time on the sleep state would get lower. And this is actually what people measured in mice. So they observed that when the mice is after a few hours of sleep, the frequency of release of these mini EPSPs gets lower. And on the other hand, the same happens on the awake state. If you want, according to the curves, the person transits from awake state to a sleep-like state, you would actually increase the amplitude of noise. And this is also what happens here. If you are a few hours of awake, the frequency of release of these minis, it gets higher. It gets higher. So this is somehow, we believe that that's somehow correlated with our observations. Moreover, maybe this is just an appendix here. We also measure power spectrums, and we observed frequencies. And where when we have this awake-like state, they are at very low powers, at very low frequencies. And then when we observe this sleep state, we have peaks close to 10 hertz. So maybe that's all I wanted to say for now. I want to thank everybody that have been supporting. Also, the cluster, this work was done in using the NeuroMat cluster, and everybody from Ribeirão Preto, thank you very much.
So hi, my name is Cesar, and I'm the last one. And I work also in the laboratory of the Professor Roque doing simulations. And I also do experiments in patch clamp in the laboratory of Professor Ricardo Leão in the Department of Physiology.
I would say Professor Doctor, if you want to
precise,
not Dr. Professor.
Yeah. And then today I will speak about the role of the subthreshold active conductances shaping the EPSP in cortical neurons. So what is an EPSP? Then we have here an EPSP that is a change in the memory potential, a small change, that it is characterized by a rise and a decay.
What and does EPSP mean? Not everybody knows.
Excitatory postsynaptic potential. So it is a change in the memory potential in the postsynaptic neuron as a result of a spike in the presynaptic neuron. So you have two neurons, the presynaptic and the postsynaptic. When the presynaptic fires, it will release in here from the vesicles, it will release neurotransmitter. In the case of an excitatory synapse, it will release glutamate, for instance. And then it will open channels in the postsynaptic neuron, and that injects some current, and then you will see a change in the memory potential. And because of the change is depolarizing the neuron, then it is an excitatory change. If the change is below for the hyperpolarizing the neuron, then it is an inhibitory postsynaptic potential. And what is interesting is that if the EPSP is large enough, it will make the neuron fire and spike. So that's the mechanism how the neurons transmit the propagation of the electrical activity. And then, so what is interesting is that the cable theory says that you can treat the subthreshold behavior of the neurons as a passive, with passive properties. It means you can model the behavior, the electrical behavior in the subthreshold part of the neuron as a circuit with a capacitance and a resistance in a battery. And then you can see this beautiful curve, this beautiful behavior. If you inject a positive current, you can see that you are charging the capacitor. And you can characterize this behavior using this equation. You can characterize the input resistance, that is the ratio of the change in the memory potential when you inject a small current. And you can see that it fits using an exponential curve. And also in this exponential behavior, you can see this parameter tau, that is the time constant, that it is related with the input resistance and the capacitance of the neuron. But what actually happens in real neurons is that they are not passive at all. So they have some another conductances that they are active conductances. And what is important in these active conductances is has this parameter that is voltage dependent. So when you differentiate the current, if you want to obtain the input resistance, if you differentiate a passive neuron, you will see that it is constant. But when you differentiate a neuron that it has active conductances, you will see also that the result is also a function that is voltage dependent, right? So, and what is interesting is that it matters for the physiology. For instance, in the in a group of neurons in the in some hypothalamic region, it was observed that the EPSP has not it has not this shape, but the shape is this. It means it rises and it stays there. And then when another EPSP comes, it sums up, and then it would continue rises and rises, and the probability to fire increases in this case. But then they remove, with a technique, with generics, they remove the channel. And then you they see that the EPSP now has the common shape. And what is important is that this is related, for instance, with the capacity of the body to control the weight. So in this case, the rat loses the control of its weight. And then we wanted to reproduce that using simulations, right? And then we simulate a neuron with a passive channel and also with this kind of channel. And then what we see is this behavior. We can see that in the hyperpolarized membrane potentials, the shape of the EPSP is this one, the usual one. And then when we depolarize the membrane potential, the EPSP is highly amplified because of the presence of this current that it is the persistent current. And also, then we wanted to see if that changes in the shape, that amplification, it was related with the changes in the properties of the neuron. In this case, with the changes of the input resistance and the membrane time constant. And what we saw was that also depolarizing the membrane potential of the neuron, we see that the input resistance increases and the membrane potential increases also. That is not the case for a passive neuron. For instance, the leak and integrate neuron and some other neuron models, they assume that the membrane is only passive. So what I'm trying to say is this. This is our hypothesis. If you have subthreshold active currents in your neuron, then you would expect to have some influence in the input resistance and in the membrane time constant. Then you will have different shapes in the EPSP and also in the IPSP when you changes the membrane potential as well. And then after the simulation, then we wanted to see if that happened in real neurons. Then I did experiments using the technique that is the patch clamp recording. And then we record the electrical activity of CA1 pyramidal cells. And also we did dynamic clamp. The interesting of this technique is that you can connect a real neuron with a simulation in real time. Then you can compute anything. You can model anything in your computer. Then you can inject it back into your neuron. And then, for instance, what I did was block the channel using a toxin, and then I injected back using dynamic clamp. And what we used was the tetrodotoxin, that is a toxin that was obtained from the puffer fish. And this is the real EPSP in real neurons. And what we did was injected an artificial EPSC. But what we're seeing here is a real EPSP. And then in the hyperpolarized membrane potential, there is the black trace. You can see in a standard shape of the EPSP. Then when we depolarized the neuron, the EPSP was amplified. And then when we perfuse the toxin, that is the red trace,
we can see that the shape of the EPSP is the same from the hyperpolarized. And then what we did was injected back the current using the dynamic clamp, and we can see that we restored the behavior, we restored the slow decay of the EPSP. And we also see the intrinsic properties in the real neurons, for instance, the input resistance and the memory time constant, and also in the control situation, you can see in the black dots, you can see that those parameters increases with the depolarization. And then when we use the tetrodotoxin, you can see that it abolishes this behavior. And we were able to restore that behavior using the dynamic clamp. It means injecting back the current using the computer. And that's the main result. And that results are already available in the bioarchive. And thank you very much. And I would thank for the financial support and all the colleagues of the laboratory as well. Thank you.
Let's say we have a 10-minute session of questions because the bus has been waiting for us the last half an hour.
So a question to Cesar. If you come back to the first slide where you showed the voltage-dependent conductance.
The real neurons?
In the model. Here. No. At the modeling stage, one back still here. When you simulate that, do you keep track of the fact that you are dealing actually with conductances? I mean, you have a V minus E reversal here.
Yeah.
And so that gives you nonlinear behavior even with a passive neuron, okay? So you will have a saturation. And so when you do your simulations, you're simulating with an injected current or with an actual conductance?
Yeah. When I did the simulation.
When you do the simulation, you have an injected current that depends on the voltage somehow? Or
in
you
the
have
simulations? Yeah. You're saying the EPSC or this current?
This current. When you simulate this situation.
I'm sorry.
I mean, when you do your simulations,
I don't understand well.
So when you do your simulations,
yeah,
the synapse is the current that you inject, or
the
it's a conductance.
Yeah, the synapse I just simulate an EPSP, a fixed one.
So, but you simulate it by injecting a current or by opening a conductance? That's my question. That's not the same.
It's a current-based, the EPSC.
So then you will have a hard time to compare it to actual experiments, because in actual experiments, that's you have a...
No. In my experiments also, I did an EPSC fixed. I injected a fixed EPSC. So it is not voltage-dependent, no. It is not conductance. It is not no conductance based in the experiments. In here. You can see this is the EPSC. Actually, I just modeled the EPSC just two ramps. One right, one ramp increasing and the other decreasing. I just used the amplifier to do that.
Yes, but that's not the part of the experiment I'm interested in. I mean, before you put TTX and when the neuron does what it wants, what you have is a conductance.
And in the synapse, you mean?
Yes. I mean, we were at 3 yards of a dynamic clamp. I mean, I'm not discussing the dynamic clamp part here.
Yeah.
I'm just discussing what happens when you showed your graphs with non-decaying synapse or fast decaying one,
uh-huh.
And you will have two effects. You can have an effect which from a voltage dependent conductance, and you expect an effect from the fact that since you're depolarizing the neuron, you're getting closer to reversal potential, and then the actual current entering into the cell is tinier. Okay, so you have a saturating effect.
Maybe and we should continue. I guess it starts to be very, really too late. And so you have a last question.
Yeah, exactly. It's a small comment.
Comment, okay.
It's a, I'm it's a you be of course this is a just a comment. You'll be very important to bridge the first talk is your name please? Renato. Renan and Rodrigo in the sense of bringing together I have a couple of questions that I hope we can discuss tomorrow so you not but the what is interesting is try to have the network the more realistic as possible.
The
point is that we can start understanding better the experimental data. This is Rodrigo has done a couple of times, coming back to certain experiments, explaining sleep and so. And particularly in your case, because you use a visual stimulus, and you try to go to this idea, I thought that you could show more the results, for instance, of repetitive stimulation. Does it contribute to plasticity, or what will happen in case you have a time-dependent plasticity or not? If you have a stimulus that repeats. This is the case in the experimentation many times. When you present the gratings, it is very common to see a strong oscillation because you have bars that are crossing with very periodic. So to try to have it in a sense of somehow to guide the simulations also as a function of the type of experiments we do, you could take the same reasoning you made for awake and sleep to the condition of arousal. For instance, you have the ascending system that is so important that keeps, so to say, the network in an up state. And this changes so much the interactions of the neurons. So it's the science paper of Ralph Galuski showing that you have plasticity-dependent change as a function of arousal. This was demonstrated using mesencephalic reticular formation. So it is a kind of a different aspect, but I would say the same of one simulation that you bridge to the other simulation to have these two things, as you put in your in the beginning of the session, that you have not really only response to a stimulus, but you have always the context. So this will be very fruitful, and I hope that by showing experimental data tomorrow, we can really define some aspects. Of course, not all, but some aspects that could be interesting to be simulated. That's what the comment.
Yeah, I think that's a very nice way to conclude the session. I think I would say, Sérgio, it would be a good idea if you visit us more often. And why don't we stay 2 weeks in Ribeirão Preto working with Zen during 2 weeks? So 2 weeks there would be wonderful. Wonderful beer, wonderful city, wonderful theater, wonderful group, a powerful cluster. And you can also send the boys and the Roque to visit you. Wonderful town, Natal, there will be Bruno. So. And for sure, we need to organize a workshop. Where is Magda? Magda left. To organize a workshop on the model in the first semester. That's clear. Now, and then invite Marcus Diesmann and Eva Loscherbach and Marcus. So people doing both, it's clear. People do... Bom... I said, so we proposed a model. It happened that this model is becoming subject of interest for many people. And we are happy of this, because one of our questions is, what should we ask for about the model? So at the beginning, we look in the literature. Now, these fellows have lots of suggestions of things they are showing us. So I think we should organize a meeting, dedicate to the model, putting together some of the people who were with us last year, and also people, probabilists, interested in the theoretical aspect. So this should be done somewhere in the first semester. There will be our new postdoc work on this. So this something must be done. I don't know. So I will ask Magda to see when you are free to come here, or maybe to Ribeirão Preto. It's a wonderful town, wonderful beer, everything. So, okay, let's thank all the speakers. Tomorrow will be a new day.